careful what you ask for. You just might get it, they say. And 2 weeks ago in Columbus, fans asked for the kind of action they've come to expect from America's premier short track series. And sure enough, they got it. Rooting and pawing, bumping and banging, hard racing, and fun to watch. And when it was over, a familiar sight in Victory Lane, too. Toledo Speedway, on the other hand, is a place where you must expect the unexpected, where demons emerge from unlikely hiding places, where in the blink of an eye, defeat can be snatched from the jaws of victory, and the thrill of victory itself isn't felt until the last possible instant. Short track racing in America resumes as the AC Delco Challenge Series stop number two. The Glass City Classic at Toledo Motor Speedway, our second visit to the state of Ohio. Under beautiful weather conditions, sunny skies will make it a lot more exciting for the fans, a very pleasant day in the grandstands, and a great day of racing for everyone concerned. Hello again, everybody. I'm Brian Drever, along with my friend Rob Albright, and we're heading up towards the front of the field here for the AC Delco Challenge Series. We've got 38 cars lined up and ready to get going here on this very, very unusual racetrack. Rob, a very difficult one for the guys to set up.
Yeah, it is, Brian. It's really almost egg-shaped. We're just walking out of turn number four. It's a little higher banked, but more narrow than turns one and two. They're a little more shallow, less steeply banked. So the drivers have to determine which end is most important to them. There's a compromise in the setup, and therein will be the secret to success or failure today.
We've got a great mix in the starting field here, too. Some of the older and more experienced drivers, we'll talk a little bit more about them in a minute, but the young guns, the guys that have really done a great job in qualifying here and setting themselves up for a performance that they can be proud of at the end of this Glass City 300, are the guys like Gary St. Amant, Brad Loney, Little Glenn, Glenn Allen Jr. Those guys are at the front of the field.
Yeah, they're in row number two. Some surprises, which we'll reserve for Ralph Shaheen a little bit later on the front row. But these kids are for real, Brian. They're going to challenge for a title this year.
Now, one of the guys that's had a lot of success here and had an unusual set of circumstances for himself last year here in Toledo is Scott Hansen in the 53.
Scott, well, what can you say about his success last year? He won one race here, and the other race he was leading when he had an on-track incident that took him out of contention and really aggravated an old injury. But he has been tough here. Five times he's been here, four times he's been here, and I think he's been in the top five four times. Only once has he dropped out of a race. One win. He's tough here at Toledo.
Well, tough. It was tough for him here last year at the Toledo race. Now, as we said before, we're making our way towards the front of the field, but I don't think we're getting there quite fast enough. So with a miracle of electronics, let's throw it up to Ralph Shaheen. He's already there.
Ryan, 64 times Mike Miller has started an AC Delco Challenge Series race. But usually, it's from back behind me, deep in the field. For the first time in his career, Mike Miller will start the Atlantic Communications Pontiac from the pole position. Mike, what was different about this time here at Toledo that allowed you to get the pole?
Well, Ralph Trickle and I have talked about lots of things, and a couple weeks ago down at Talladega, he suggested that I try something a little bit different, and we did, and here we are.
That's Dick Trickle, of course, that he is talking about. And you know, Brian, it's not surprising to find out that Mike Miller and Dick Trickle put their heads together. These are the two people that worked together and came up with the rules and the configuration to run the 9-to-1 motor that has become so famous in ASA racing.
Thank you, Ralph. And as the field gets ready to go, we want to show you how the points are stacking up right now. Of course, this is based on the results of only one race that last weekend, or 2 weekends ago in Columbus, Ohio.
They're chasing the black number 88. That's something they've been accustomed to doing over the years. Mike Eddy gunning for an unprecedented 8th national championship, but he can't afford a single slip this year. With these young guys like Loney and Glenn Allen Jr., Gary St. Amant, and that cagey old veteran Mike Miller. Remember, he started so strong a year ago. He thinks that they're not going to have the consistency, Brian, that will keep him at the top all year.
After qualifying, these points tightened up a little bit among the top four, but they're pretty much still in this order. There's Scott Hansen starting sixth after the first race, and of course we've talked about his success here at this racetrack. This was, I think, still, in coming here, probably the most exciting and most fun race we did all year last year, out of all due respect to the rest of the races that we had on the AC Delco Challenge Series in 1994. I'll tell you what, this was a tough act to follow.
Well, one name that you don't see in the top ten is the name of Dave Sensaba. He was the guy that battled all season with that ninth-ranked driver right now, Brian Reffner. Sensaba, if you weren't with us a couple of weeks ago at Columbus, started near the front, ran very, very well, and then had some mechanical problems. So he'll start kind of deep. Well, actually, he would have started deep. There was some snafus in the tech line today, and a couple of the drivers thought they were going to be relegated to the tail. So he has been put back in his original qualifying position. But Sensaba, you know, they talk about this sophomore jinx. Hopefully, it's not going to be a thing that will plague him all year.
That was another look there at the pole sitting number 18, the tomato red car of Mike Miller, and the whole field, 38 cars strong, stretched around. Now, we do see a number of the cars out there, and of course, out in the starting grid is our Ralph Shaheen, and he's the guy we've been waiting for to get this race going. Ralph?
Ryan, we caught up with Paul Pucci, who is the field sales executive for the folks at AC Delco. Paul, you're going to get started today. How about it?
Yes, sir. Gentlemen, start your engine!
The engines are fired and we're fired up for the start of the Glass City 300. Join us in just a moment and we'll get this one going.
Most trackers can follow the trail only as long as the weather holds up. Unless it's a tracker spurred on with genuine AC spark plugs. AC plugs fire faster than lightning for performance so smooth, even the thunder claps. And that'll keep your engine on the trail to a longer life.
Call 1-800-AC-DELCO. It's like buying time.
So better track down some AC spark plugs. Vitamins do for your body, VitaWinds does for your car.
It's not about winning the most races. I tried that 2 years in a row. You just got to surround yourself with the best people, the best car, and Goodyear Eagles, the best tires in the world. Then you just got to go out and finish every single race.
Goodyear, number one in racing, number one in tires.
Goodyear Eagles. And 31 top five finishes. Yeah, that ought to do it.
Over the years, Little Caesars has run promotions with many of its neighbors. Two pizzas and a back rub. Two pizzas and a colorful fish. And some chattering teeth. And this thing. And one of our most popular, the perm.
I'll never top that one.
Finally, two pizzas and a movie.
Wow.
It's the Blockbuster Video Pizza Pizza Deal. Buy a top-of-the-line Little Caesars Pizza Specialty Pizza, medium one-topping pizza, and get a free Blockbuster Video rental when you rent two.
Pizza Pizza.
The 1995 AC Delco Challenge Series, live on TNN, is brought to you in part by Wynn Oil Company, makers of quality automotive car care products. Remember, when it's Wynn, it works. By your GM Goodrich Service Dealer. We want your business. By Goodyear, number one in tires. By Little Caesars Pizza Pizza, where you always get two great pizzas for one low price. And by Pep Boys Automotive Supercenter. As the field circles the Toledo Motor Speedway here for the Glass City 300, let's run down the starting grid for you. We've touched on a few of them. Let's fill in the rest.
Hey, here's the big surprise. Mike Miller on the pole a little bit, but J.D. Summers, the fastest of 11 qualified rookies in the junior Hanley-owned Ford Quaker State Thunderbird.
And on row number two, Glenn Allen Jr. in the Eaglewood Construction CarQuest Pontiac ran second last time out. Pink driver suit and all this week sits on the second row alongside Brad Loney in the number 33 Winnebago Flexsteel H&W Chevrolet. He finished third in Columbus, his best finish last time, his career best qualifying effort this week.
The third row, Bob Senecker in his Johnsonville Foods Ford Thunderbird, and local favorite Todd Forbes from Bryan, Ohio
in the Yoder Ford Maystow Construction Ford Thunderbird.
Pole sitter in Columbus, Gary St. Amant, pilot of the Wynn Sport City Thunderbird, the inside of row four. One spot better than seven-time ASA champion Mike Eddy, who drove the Goodwrench Pontiac to victory in Columbus, setting up a run at title number eight.
The fifth row, the prodigy and the mentor, Eddie Sharp Jr., who is in ASA because of 1993 champion Johnny Benson Jr., who has a Busch Grand National week off, and he's going to come back to challenge his old mates.
Maybe a little bit further back through the field. There's Tony Roper. Boy, he had a great run last time, too. We talked about Mike Miller running from 19th to 4th. Tony Roper ran from 25th to 11th. Here's Scott Hansen, Dave Sensaba. Sensaba driving one of two Monte Carlos in the race this week.
The eighth row, Matt Hutter, just a youngster driving as a teammate to Glenn Allen Jr. His dad is an ASA engine builder. And Brett Bell, who crashed hard in practice, a very impressive comeback from that for a strong start.
Kidded Joe Knott about borrowing a Valvoline hood from Mark Martin. Well, he's got one on there, and he'll be running hard today with Steve Shive and a Chevrolet back there.
Road racer Bobby Archer and veteran Jay Sauter, who was a factor in this thing a year ago, started row number 10.
And a little bit further back, Brian Reppner, rookie contender last year, sits well up in the points. We saw that at the beginning. And Ted Smokestad in the Chevrolet that he's driving there, sponsored by Super America, one of our great sponsors.
The 12th row, Steve Holzhausen in the Motorsports of Rice Lake Ford and the BASF Finishmaster Chevy of rookie Pat Bordeaux. In the 13th row, veteran Harold Fair and rookie making his first start today, Brandon Sperling in the Ultra Custom Wheel Chevy. Harold getting some help from Dana Corporation this weekend. Todd Oliver, the racing insurance guy, along with Rick Beebe, who had earned his way in with the last chance race yesterday, as did some of these other drivers. Tom Jones, Yale Conley, the racing surgeon from Vienna, West Virginia. Bobby Dodder making his first start in some time. Kent Stock, we're going to be talking about him quite a bit, and the Popa Joe's Pizza, brand new sponsor for him, along with Kinetic. Matt Kenseth. Jeff Neal, starting deep. Watch for him to move up early. Rookie Rick Miller, racing veteran Dennis Lampman in the 18th row.
From row 16 back, these were the guys that did not get in, either from qualifying or the last chance. They had to get in based on their points from this season.
And we're going racing.
We're getting ready to go green. The flag is in the hand of Roger Slacken, waving, and out they go. And look at Summers making a move on Mike Miller in the very first lap. Going down the backstretch now. Mike Miller trying to fight him up. They're side by side on the backstretch. And J.D. Summers was only a thousandth of a second slower in qualifying than Mike Miller. Mr. Inside is on the inside, and J.D. Summers, the rookie's on the outside, going by.
And he's got the lead. You know, I asked him before this race if he had some rookie jitters. He said, no, I probably got as many laps on this track in late model competition as anybody, and it shows as he's taken the lead very, very quickly away from fast qualifier Mike Miller.
Nudging hard up from behind in third spot there, Glenn Allen Jr. in the number 15 machine. And we have got a heck of a race going on. J.D. Summers trying to run off and hide early here. Mike Miller drifting a little bit high. Glenn Allen's got a fender underneath, so the pole sitter is having a little bit of trouble here in the early going. J.D. Summers in the 22 machine, off and running.
I'll tell you one thing about Mike Miller. Don't be alarmed or concerned that he seems to be dropping back. He normally sets his race car up, Brian, for long runs. He normally is working from deep in the field, and he may be considering that. Glenn may get by him early, but that doesn't mean that Mike's out of contention at this very early stage of the race.
J.D. Summers obviously has the line on this racetrack with all the experience. Even though he is a rookie contender, he's now put about five or six car lengths on the rest of the pack, led by Mike Miller. Then it's Glenn Allen Jr., the number 33, with the unusual three threes on the side of Brad Loney. And we're just a few laps into this race, and already it's single file all the way around the racetrack.
But it's brand parity up front. It's the Ford of J.D. Summers out in front, the Pontiacs of Mike Miller and Glenn Allen Jr., and then the fastest Chevy in ASA, as his press agent likes to say, Brad Loney, operating in fourth position. Todd Forbes now is beginning to close up, and a great battle behind them between Bob Seneca and Mike Eddy for sixth position.
There's the two veterans, Mike Eddy and Bob Seneca on the outside. Gary St. Amant tucked in behind Seneca. That's where he started. Mike Eddy was on the outside. Great quote from Gary St. Amant. Had us laughing down there in the pit. I said, Gary, you kids go out there and have a good time, but have a little respect for your elders. He said, I'm sitting behind Bob Seneca and inside of Mike Eddy, and I got to respect them too.
Gary says this has to be his day. It's the 7th of the month, driving car number 7, started 7th, and his girlfriend Tracy is celebrating her birthday today. He can't miss.
I heard he was actually sandbagging a little bit to get that number 7 spot. And, of course, he was fighting the 0-7 of Todd Forbes, who started 6th. So there was a little bit of that number mojo working out there today, and they were all trying to get it.
Well, there is Gary St. Amant now. He's beginning to close up on Bob Seneca. You can see how much gap. Mike Eddy running all by himself, and it's Seneca that's falling back just a little bit in the early going in car number 84.
Well, Mike Eddy has gotten around Bob Seneca and around the outside, of course, and Gary St. Jorge Lamonte started there. He's trying to get up to the five leaders. J.D. Summers losing a little bit more ground here now. He had really stretched out a lead there for a while, but it appears as though Mike Miller, Glenn Allen Jr., Brad Loney, and Todd Forbes in the 07 are all starting to close a little ground, or at least not let him get so far away.
And you can see just a moment ago, the Benson machine, Johnny Benson Jr. in the Port City BSA Berger Chevrolet was really beginning to put some pressure on Gary St. Amant in car number 7. There's Mike Miller still hanging on to second position. You won't see any youngster mistakes, if you will. Glenn Allen Jr., Brad Loney, still relatively new in their ASA racing careers. But they're going to be patient. They know there's a long way to go today. They don't need to worry too much. We expect a lot of yellows. That's what we always have here. And Johnny Benson now, Brian, has made his way past Gary St. Amant and Tony Raines, who really felt the pressure for a strong run today after a so-so debut at Columbus with his team. Now he begins to pull up as well in car number 87.
Johnny Benson, of course, the champion of the ASA Series a couple of years ago, has now moved on to the Busch Series and is leading that one, and here he is. Come back, this is what he likes to do. Boy, he hangs around here. He's been with Eddie Sharp, helping Eddie out last time around in Columbus. He was just there to help. This time he's out there to race. The teacher and the pupil started side by side, and it looks like the teacher didn't give up quite all of his tricks. He's doing a little bit better right now than Eddie Sharp. Let's go down to Ralph Shaheen. He's got a little extra word about Mike Miller.
Ryan, I don't think there's anything to worry about with Mike Miller just yet. I checked with his crew chief. He said Mike hasn't radioed anything in. I think Mike is just pacing himself at this point. In talking to most of the drivers, they said they won't start driving overly aggressive until after the first 50 laps. The first 50 here at Toledo are usually pretty wild. Everybody's going to try to settle down, get a feel for the car, and then really get after it.
But we also see that Glenn Allen Jr., neither Glenn Allen Jr. nor Brad Loney, making a lot of effort to get around Mike Miller. They just figure that the veteran driver is as good as anybody to follow around. They're just going to let him set the pace. He knows exactly how to do just that. Younger drivers might be a little bit more impetuous than a veteran like Mike Miller, so they're content to sit in behind him. And whatever J.D. Summers does out front, well, that's just, they're just going to let it happen.
And hats off early to 11 of 38 starters, rookies here at Toledo, and they're doing a great job early on.
There's Mike Miller. Now, they have not quite started to run into traffic yet. J.D. Summers, on the other hand, is starting to run into a little bit of the tail end of the field there as he makes his way around the 71 of A.J. Cooper and the 98 of Kent Stauffer. And now he's got a little bit of clear track to run in. Clearly, another exciting Toledo Glass City 300 getting set up right here. We're in the early laps, so come on back.
No mistake about it, I was definitely in cruiser heaven. Even my wife looked somehow different. And there I was prowling the streets on the new Kawasaki Vulcan 800. V-twin rumbling, chrome gleaming in sight. Is this for real? Or am I just dreaming?
The Vulcan 800 from Kawasaki. It's as real as it gets.
It's a major breakthrough in auto protectant technology. Formula 2001 Super Protectant. It provides a more brilliant, longer-lasting shine than Armorall on vinyl and leather. And look, in the Arizona desert, Formula 2001 brought back the shine to UV-faded vinyl, rubber, even leather. Get the new standard in automotive protectant technology. Formula 2001 with 50% more active shining ingredients than Armorall. Get Formula 2001 products today.
They'll cover up your springtime needs. Plant some new ideas in your head with a steady flow of quality products, all at rock-bottom prices. Ace Mayday. Hurry in while it's in full bloom.
If you're looking for a reliable place to service your car or truck, I've got great news for you.
Now at Pep Boys, air conditioning system check for only $19.99.
Come to Pep Boys and drive away happy.
Welcome back, everybody. These folks are enjoying a nice sunny day here in Toledo as the Glass City 300 is just underway, and not seconds after we went to commercial break, Tony Roper in the number 10 car just kind of eased on around the side of the track, came to a stop. There he is, sitting in the middle of the racetrack. Rob Albright, tough afternoon, at least right now. The rest, everybody else still moving. He's not.
Yeah, my guess it's electrical. The Child's Tire Snyder Equipment Chevrolet looks like his day may be over. Well, we have a brand new sponsor, a whole host of them in 1995. One of them is one of the most interesting, the National Burn Victim Foundation. And A.J. Cooper carries their colors on his Ford Thunderbird. We talked to him about it last week. A.J., you have a new and rather unusual sponsor for 1995, and I think it involves this little friend you're holding here. What's this all about?
Well, this is for the National Burn Victim Foundation. We're going to try to help them raise some money to buy these bears for children that are burnt. And this is Professor Gaynor, and he heads the foundation, and he can tell you all about it.
Professor Gaynor, tell us just a little bit about the National Burn Victim Foundation. What is its purpose and what's its goal?
Well, I'm the founder of the National Burn Victim Foundation. We're heading into our 21st year, and our goal is that we're an advocate for burn victims, especially children, because a burn is one of the most painful, most traumatic experiences that anyone can sustain. But a child is not a small adult. They're different physiologically, biologically, psychologically. The child grows and is subject to surgical procedure after surgical procedure and pain, pain, pain. And I'll tell you, after all the things that we've done, we've touched thousands of people's lives, but these teddy bears, I tell you, they have magic. Bears do have magic. They have a therapeutic value to the kids. Kids love these bears, and you're making a difference. And I thank AJ and the Racing Association here for helping. God bless them all.
Well, AJ, just one final question. I understand that you at one point were a burn victim, and so you really know firsthand what these things might mean to some young ones.
Yeah, I have a unfortunate experience of being burnt once, and it'll be a big help for them because it is very painful.
Well, it's going to be an exciting year for the National Burn Victim Foundation and its new association with the ASAEC Delco Challenge Series, and you got a nice young man here to work with.
Well,
Professor Gaynor,
we got 50,000 bears to go for kids, so we need a lot of help. Thank you, sir.
Here's the address if you'd like to get involved. The Cooper Morton Racing Team will accept your contributions. 269 Northeast 69 Highway in Clay Como, Missouri, 64119. Help out these young ones. It's quite a good cause. AJ also wanted us to extend his thanks to a couple of guys, Brett Bell and Brian Reffner. He was involved in an accident yesterday. They provided parts to put car number 71 back together.
We have just gone back to green here, and it is still J.D. Summers, rookie driver in the number 22 car, who is out in front. And veteran Mike Miller, the pole sitter for this Class City 300, sits in second spot ahead of the ahead of a couple of the kids, as we call them out there. Glenn Allen Jr. and Brad Loney, two of the younger drivers who, of course, are racing well beyond their tender years, you might say. These guys are veterans behind the wheel, even though they are some of the younger. And then Mike Eddy in the number 88, the Good Wrench Pontiac, the man in black, is coming. He's there.
Seems like no matter which type of stock car racing you watch, the super speedways down south or the short tracks up here, no matter where those two guys start in those black GM Goodrich cars, they go right to the front. It's always Earnhardt and somebody in NASCAR, and it's always Mike Eddy and somebody battling in ASA.
We talked about the number Mojo. I think there's something about that black Goodrich.
Boy, I don't know what
it is. Mojo working there, too. In any case, they are circulating the track, the front five, with a bit of a gap back to Todd Forbes in the 07, and Johnny Benson Jr. in the 21, running 6th and 7th. But here's a look at the first, second, and third place cars, and with that caution flag, Mike Miller and Glenn Allen Jr. have, of course, closed the gap on the leader, J.D. Summers, in his number 22 Ford Quaker State Thunderbird.
I did want to say just a quick hello to Linda McCurdy, who's the wife of the crew chief, Kevin McCurdy, for Tony Roper. Tony looks like he's out of the race today, but they're celebrating its 10th anniversary. Linda's at home watching. Linda, I know this is the way you wanted it to go, but happy anniversary from us.
Again, down to Ricochet Ralph Shaheen down inside the racetrack for an update, Ralph.
Eddie Sharp in the 21st Century Super Fitness entry, who is fourth in the rookie points, is down one cylinder. The plug came off. They put it back on. It didn't stay, so he's running on five. We had Bobby Archer, Bobby Daughter, and Ken Stopper all make pit stops during that last yellow to readjust the suspension, tires, and fuels. They're back out.
And we've got a spin up in turn number three. It was the number 54 rookie driver, Steve Shive, who looped it. Steve had started in 18th position in his Rick Cole Budweiser Chevrolet. Everybody was able to either move to the high side or the low side. It looked precarious because there was a whole host of cars coming on the scene. Shive is okay. He had 7 starts last year. That's the maximum number you can have without violating your rookie eligibility for the following year.
So there is the Budweiser Chevrolet, and hats off to Steve Shive for a great job of driving after a little misdemeanor there. We'll come back to the Glass Fitting 300 where you can enjoy lots more racing along with these folks right after this.
Well, the battery's good, and starter's brand new, so I figure it's got to be the alternator, right? I go into the AutoZone, get a new one. Well, this guy says, well, let's check the old one first. No sense buying something you may not need. Well, turns out it's a voltage regulator. I tell you, I could have spent a lot of time swapping out parts till I got it right. But with AutoZone, piece of cake.
Used to be Sunday was the only day you had time to fix a real family meal. But now with so many choices of chicken and side dishes at KFC, you can have Sunday dinner 7 days a week.
If you got lots of leisure time and nothing else to do, and want to be happy as we, just grab your hat and get your boots on, pretty soon you'll be long on to the cowboy.
Championship Rodeo on TNN tonight.
The AC Delco Challenge Series, the premier short track racing series, has joined forces with Short Track Racing Magazine, the premier publication geared to short track racing fans. For subscription information, call 1-800-468-7876. Now, real quick, let's go to the premier pit reporter in auto racing, Ralph Shaheen. Ralph?
Well, we got a lot of activity going on in the pits down here. We had a bunch of cars coming in and out. Here comes the 54 machine inside. Everything seems to be okay with that car. He said he just had to get out of the throttle due to a slower car. Him and Jay Sauter got together, and he said just one of those racing things. Tony Roper lost the motor. That's what happened to the 10 car, by the way. Brad Loney came in. He took tires and fuel, readjusted his suspension, as did Harold Fair and Dave Sentiba. Now we're waiting for the Miller machine, Rick Miller, to come back through. He's got a leaky valve cover on his engine.
Well, I have to ask, Rob Albright, Brad Loney, among the leaders, the only one that came in that time, and what's that going to do to his situation?
Well, it's still early, and we do anticipate a lot of cautions. Brad has now already passed four or five cars as he marches toward the front. You never know. Sometimes that strategy of getting out of sync with the rest of the leaders works, and sometimes it doesn't. Here in Toledo, it's always a dangerous decision to do that, because you can get caught up in something that happens on the racetrack that you're likely to avoid if you're running in the top four or five. So I guess the jury is still out as to whether or not that was a good choice or a poor one.
Well, there is something to that kind of stop when everybody else you're racing with stops. And then on the other hand, we've seen races won and lost, I might add, by guys who decide to do a little bit of a renegade pit stop program, do a little something their own way. We've seen it work out for the good. We've also seen it work out for the poor. So we'll file that away for future reference, the fact that Brad Loney stopped during the second caution here in the Glass City 300.
And we said, don't worry about Mike Miller. He'd be back, and he is. After this caution period, now he's really beginning to challenge J.D. Summers. And as I told you, he set the car up to go the long runs.
Here's a battle for eighth spot on the outside as Gary St. Amant, the number seven machine on the inside. It is, of course, the Bluebird, Bob Seneca in the 84. And then fighting his way around the outside there, Scott Hansen. So this is a great battle going on for eighth spot after we look for leaders moving to go.
And here's a pass for the lead. J.D. Summers slides up out of the groove. Mike Miller takes over the top spot. Glenn Allen Jr. comes along with him. Mike Eddy not able to get by, at least not yet.
Well, as wide as this racetrack is, Rob Albright, it seems as though the groove is actually fairly narrow. We've heard drivers talking about getting just a little bit too high, and up there in the marbles, there's a lot of loose stuff high on the racetrack.
What happens, though, I think, Brian, normally here, when it's warm, as the race progresses, the cars do tend to move a little bit higher on the racetrack. That does run into the second groove, so you'll see guys choosing different lines. Expect side-by-side racing maybe after the first 150 laps of this race.
So now the race is between Mike Miller, the number 18, the pole sitter is back out in front. Glenn Allen Jr., the number 15 machine, who qualified third, sat right behind Mike on the starting grid. So those two are the ones going at it for the lead right now. J.D. Summers has drifted back significantly, four or five car lengths, and Mike Eddy's challenging him for third spot.
Glenn Allen Jr. pressuring Mike Miller for the lead. And what a story on this Glenn Allen car. That sponsor, you can see it on the tail panel, Eaglewood Construction. It's a husband and wife team. It's a development company, Randy and Mary Ellen. from Rockford, Michigan. They happened to meet Glenn Allen Jr. at a restaurant. Heard him talking about racing. They say, "How would it cost us to paint our name on your team?" He told them, they said, "We'll be out to your shop." They ended up writing a big check as his primary sponsor. They have nothing to sell in California. They just love Glenn Allen Jr. and they love ASA. This is truly the great American dream in stock car racing.
Well, you know, we were both hanging around when some of the story was being related. You know how the gossip in the pit goes, and the guys at Glenn Allen's crew were asked, "Well, what do you guys need anything when you're on your way to Toledo?" And they were joking with Randy, and they said, "Yeah, oh, a couple of grand." It showed up on their desk the next day. They said, "No, take it back. We were just kidding. Let's go again down to Ralph Sahin."
There seems to be more to the story of Brad Looney. Apparently, he's got a problem with his header now, a crack in the header, and that'll cost a few percent in his horsepower, Rob. So now Brad Looney has to do it all on the setup of the race car, not relying on the horsepower of the motor.
And you know, Brian, that might not be a significant problem at a slow racetrack, but this is a track where they're hitting maybe 125 at the midpoint of the straightaway, average lap speeds over 109 miles an hour, and that will cost him significantly. 10 or 15 horsepower, maybe all he'll give up if the problem doesn't worsen. And we saw Ted Musgrave win an ASA race a couple of years ago with a cracked header, but you know, it will create a different kind of an approach to this event for that entire team.
Now, Mike Miller finding a way around Rick Miller in the number 31 car. Rick Miller out of Dunbar, Pennsylvania, the Extreme Home Powerflow Chevrolet. Both of them there looked like Mike wanted to go high, and Glenn thought about ducking down low, thinking maybe Rick Miller would move up a little bit. He used it to his advantage. Didn't work. Mike's around the outside. Glenn went with him.
Mike Eddy now begins to close in on fellow Pontiac driver. Look at this now. We've got Pontiacs running 1, 2, 3. And into the fourth position, I believe, is, if I'm not mistaken, Johnny Benson Jr. No, it's still J.D. Summers. Benson is right there, and right behind Benson is Tony Raines in car number 87. Ralph, a pretty good battle back there, but J.D. Summers is sliding back in the field.
It's only a matter of time before. Oh, we got big problems down in turn one, Rob.
I'll say we got big problems down. It almost took out the leader, and it did take out the number two car in the racetrack, the 15 of Glenn Allen Jr., not able to avoid a spinning Bill Baird in the Saturn Machine Allen's Body Shop Chevrolet. Mike Miller escapes unscathed. That puts Mike Eddy in the second spot, and there you can see a little bit of aerodynamically challenged bodywork there for the 15 car.
Well, the question, and I'm sure one that Ralph will be heading pitside to get answered, did it do any suspension damage, any chassis damage to the right front corner of car number 15? He didn't hit really hard, and maybe something that they can push and prod and bend and retape back into position. Well, we'll take another peek at it. I didn't actually see it develop on the racetrack. We'll get a chance here in just a second.
I just heard the massive intake of breath here at the track, and there it is.
Now, there's 22. J.D. Summers. It's already happened. You can see Bill Baird sliding down. Now, where's Glenn Allen Jr.? He's already up at the high side, and he's already made contact
hard
with somebody.
Yep.
I'm going to look at the tail end of Rick Miller's car number 31, because I think that Allen might have hit him in the back. We'll see. Look at the left side of your screen. That's where it's happening. Here comes. You're looking at J.D. Summers in the black car putting a lap on Steve Scheib, and right at the top of the screen, the damage has already been done. No, it is not Rick Miller that he hit, and I'm not really sure who it was.
In any case, we have a change among the leaders. We will delete Glenn Allen Jr. in the 15 from second spot, put Mike Eddy in his place, and we will resume in just a few moments.
When you work with guys like Walter Petty and Wallace, you learn that keeping a car on the road means preventing problems before they start, and that's especially true with Radiator.
Radiator Restore Sealer Conditioner prevents the buildup of rust and sludge that causes radiator failure, and it stops radiator leaks in seconds.
Radiator Restore lubricates and conditions your entire cooling system, plus it's environmentally safe. Why wait till problems heat up? Use Radiator Restore and keep your cool.
If you're looking for a reliable place to service your car or truck, I've got great news for you. It's a Pep Boys Automotive Super Center. No matter what you drive, their ASC certified technicians are here when you need them, day or night, even on Sunday. Or Raybestos Brakes, DRW Rack and Pinion Repair, Diagnostic Tune-Ups, even air conditioning. For dealer quality service at prices you can afford, come to Pep Boys and drive away happy.
They're state-of-the-art purebred racing machines, but please don't call them cars. It's the Super Truck Series Jerden Nelson Truck 150, Saturday on TNN Motorsports.
Nowhere else are the colors of spring and summer more vibrant than at Opryland USA. And right now, you can be in the center of all its beauty with our spring into summer vacation package. Plan your special getaway to Nashville and you'll stay 4 days and three nights at the spectacular Opryland Hotel. You'll find yourself on the mighty General Jackson Showboat for a morning or midday cruise. There's Opryland Theme Park, where you'll get a one-day admission to all the rides and shows and a concert ticket to see one of country's hottest stars in Nashville on stage. You'll travel by river taxi to the Wild Horse Saloon in downtown Nashville, the most exciting country dance club around. And what would the trip be without a performance of the world-famous Grand Ole Opry or a taping of Music City Tonight? We've thought of it all, just $2.59 per person. Don't wait. It's only available May 21st through June 4th. Call 615-872-0600 and discover all the beauty of Opryland USA.
America's premier short track series returns to Toledo, Ohio in the Glass City 300. Brian Drever and Rob Albright up here in the booth and the hardworking Ralph Shaheen down inside. And a hardworking crew, we knew they had a shot of what went on out there. They just had to find it. Here it is.
Well, you can see Mike Miller goes to the low side of Bill Baird. I don't think Bill saw him coming. He was going to the bottom to try to take that line. And it looks like Glenn Allen's contact was with the leader, Mike Miller. Very little damage to the rear, and Glenn is back to the racetrack. And I think he's okay. Ralph, I know, is down there. And it's just updated us. But, yeah, it's just some cosmetic damage.
We're back to racing, and if Mike Miller has a problem with Glenn Allen Jr. on his tail, he's going to have a big problem now. The number 88, Mike Eddy's in second spot right now. Mike Eddy, who started this race in eighth position, the outside of row four, has now worked his way up through, staying out of trouble, in contention for the lead. So you've got two great veteran race car drivers, a seven-time champion, one who sat on the pole here in Mike Miller for the very first time in his long career. Let's go once again down to Ralph Shaheen with an update on the pit stop.
Well, you guys were correct about the cosmetic damage to both Mike Eddy and, of course, to the car of Glenn Allen Jr., but the story is the 22 of J.D. Summers. He currently runs in third, but he's down a cylinder. Lost it early on, and now he's still able to hold on to the hard-charging Johnny Benson.
That's pretty amazing. Of course, Canadian legend Junior Hanley builds, owns, and prepares this race car for J.D. Summers, so that's why he's still able to hang on in spite of being down a cylinder. As Tony Raines is now challenging, it looks like there he is, Glenn Allen, for fourth position. Tony Raines started 12th, has come to fourth. He told us in Columbus it might take a while for his team to gel with him as the new driver and Howie Letow, crew chief. They're both really quiet, but it's coming together here in Toledo. And Tony has always run very well on the high bank racetracks.
Here are the two leaders, the red 18, the tomato red 18 of Mike Miller out of Marietta, Georgia. Mike driving the Atlanta Communications Pontiac and the familiar GM Goodrich Pontiac of Mike Eddy. A little bit of damage to the right front end there on the black car. We don't see any damage to the left rear, which is where the contact was made, to Mike Miller's car. These two guys really outdistancing the rest of the field. J.D. Summers staying close. Number 87 car of Tony Raines making a run at him now, as you said. And Johnny Benson Jr. very patiently running along the pit side.
Eddie Sharp's car sits motionless in the pits. Bobby Archer's been in and out under green. And we've got a major crash again, this time in the same location, in between turns one and two, involving Bobby Dotter almost collecting Red Bell. And there is the machine, the 08 of Dotter, the Loop Tech Chevrolet.
What a difference a year makes. We've said that on several occasions. Now, last year, it seemed as though all the incidents were going on down here in turns three and four. This time out, everything that's happened thus far has happened up in turns one and two.
I believe Tom Jones may have been involved in that incident as we watched the leader, Mike Miller, who was under heavy pressure from fellow Pontiac driver Mike Eddy. It did look like Tom Jones in the Felpro Pace Jacks Pontiac may have been involved in that as well. There, you can see the right rear bodywork has been ripped away on that automobile.
That probably didn't happen all by itself, so it's safe, a very safe thing to assume, Rob, that something, some altercation has taken place there for
That's
Tom
it, wreck
Jones.
My credibility. I'm supposed to be the color guy. I'm supposed to get knows all about this stuff, you know?
Well, you know, I've always admired your remarkable grasp of the obvious as well as my own.
Yeah.
And right now, because we have a lull in the action, it's obvious that this would be a good time to take a little bit of a pause, at least from what's going on here at the racetrack. Give you a chance to look at some important messages. We'll be right back.
There was a time when a truck was just a truck. Not anymore.
Whether you're riding the range doing the town in style.
Four to your favorite fishing holes.
Betterbilt makes a full line of Pizzazz accessories that'll make your truck as much of an individual as you are. Pizzazz by Betterbilt. The name says it all.
Speed.
Excitement.
Sliding out of control, spinning.
Pocono Raceway. See speed and excitement. Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and the stars of Winston Cup Racing invade Pocono Raceway twice in 95. June 11th, it's the UAW GM Teamwork 500. July 16th, it's the Miller Genuine Draft 500. Both events sold out in 94. Call 1-800-RACEWAY now while tickets last. Operators standing by.
Before you buy an Accord or Camry, compare their surface beauty to the Subaru Legacy. For on a slippery surface, only the all-wheel drive Legacy automatically transfers power from the wheels that slip to the wheels that grip to help keep you out of the slide. And only the Legacy offers the active safety in Subaru all-wheel drive, all for a purchase price under Accord and Camry. So drive the car whose greatest beauty is its surface beauty. For a limited time, get 1.9% financing or lease for just $199 a month.
It has sleek, stunning lines, precise engineering, an innovative, award-winning design, and a sporty power red finish. But we're not here to amaze you with its finish. We're here to amaze you with its start. Just pull the trigger, push the button, and you're trimming. No hassle, always easy. The revolutionary new Home Light push-button start trimmer. Sure, it's got a great finish, but you'll love it for its start.
Motorhome facilities for Group 5 Sports and the AC Delco Challenge Series are provided by Winnebago Industries. For more information about Winnebago, call them at 1-800-643-4892.
30 cars, Brian, still being shown on the lead lap. Watching Glenn Allen Jr. and Brad Loney, as well as Todd Forbes, moving back up through the field after early pit stops. Tom Jones, there he is, the zero machine. He's been in and back out, as has Bobby Dotter. There he is on the high side. So just cosmetic damage now as we go back to green.
We do have an in-car camera courtesy of Tony's Pizza, and that comes out of Randy Larson's car, the 02. Randy had some trouble here. He broke a cylinder head. Valve cover gasket, I knew I was in the right direction. Valve cover gasket leaked, and caused him not to be able to qualify for the race, but he was generous and kind enough to loan his in-car camera and put it in Tony Raines' car. Tony's Pizza, we'll have a look from inside the number 87 of Tony Raines.
And I think it made Raines faster because he's come from 12th. He's now riding 4th and challenging for that third spot right behind J.D. Summers. Tony, of course, new to this team, the Baker Enterprises Cleanburn Pontiac operation. He brought Cleanburn with him to this new team.
Studio Gear, they're the folks that make that rig that Randy Larson has taken it upon himself to buy his own in-car camera, puts it in his car, and allows the signal to be used on our broadcast. We're really grateful to folks from Tony's Pizza and to Randy Larson for his use of that in-car camera. It'll give us a look out the front of the number 87 car. Tony Raines running in fourth spot right now. And pushing J.D. Summer with that lip engine. He's got down a cylinder, according to Ralph Shaheen. So he's down on power, even though his car is handling extremely well.
Raines is a non-factor in the opening run of the season in Columbus. Started 27th, improved somewhat, but finished 15th the lap down. And a lot of people said, well, maybe he's not as good as we've always said he was. And they were very premature in that decision. It does take time for any driver to acclimate himself to a new operation. And Tony, it's only taken a single event.
There's another look out in front of the 87 there. You can see the two leaders up in front, third place right in front of him. And there is a look from the outside of the number 87 car, Tony Raines. The Baker Enterprises Cleanburn Pontiac running fourth right now. And back up front here is Mike Miller and Mike Eddy. Mike and Mike. Last year it was Miller and Miller battling for points. Butch Miller and Mike Miller battling for points all season long early. And towards the end of the season, of course, Mike Miller faded. Mike Eddy made a charge at Butch Miller towards the end, but Butch ended up winning the championship. Now we got Mike and Mike going at it up front here. And no change in the leaders right now. They have settled in and paced themselves toward the finish of this Class City 300.
Weeks ago at Columbus, it took Mike only getting 15 laps to get to the head of the class, and he was never passed after that. He's having a much more difficult time getting around cagey veteran Mike Miller in the, as you call it, tomato red, number 18. You ought to see, you know, the tomatoes we get in Florida. If it was tomato red, that thing would be somewhere with 14 to king.
Well, Mike
Mike says you can call him a veteran, you can call him a cagey veteran, just don't call him a grizzled veteran, so we won't.
Even if he is.
I've made no secret about Mike Miller from Marietta, Georgia. I live in Atlanta. Mike's my neighbor. I mentioned him early in the 1994 season before the AC Delta Challenge Series began. And you know, I got a personal favorite in Mike, and it's really satisfying to see him run this far up front. But I'll tell you, another guy that's making a great run through the field right now, he started 20th, is Jay Sauter, the number one automobile. Of course, he was the victim of last year's finish by Butch Miller, ended up second after he was leading the race. Coming into the final couple of corners, Butch got inside, nudged him up a little bit, and made a run at the finish line, beating him by a fender. Jay Sauter has run from 20th to 10th on the racetrack, so we'll be keeping an eye on the number one car. There he is, the first chiropractic Metalcraft Pontiac.
And what a great story it is. This machine competed two or three times last year with another driver behind the wheel. Jay began with KC Motorsports in 1994. It's a team that had financed, was self-financed through much of the last couple of years. Its car owner, Chris Weiss, we were sorry to see him go, but he simply could not continue to pump the dollars into the organization that he had. So Jay spent a few races with Gunderman as we've got a spin coming out of turn number four, just past the start-finish line. It's racing surgeon, Dr. Yale Conley, who barely avoids what would have been very painful contact with a large tire entering turn number one. Didn't see what happened. We simply heard the squeal of tires right by our booth, and he's going to get that machine righted and continue around.
Well, fortunately, it was without further incident to any of the other cars on the racetrack. Dr. Yale Conley doing a little surgical agricultural alteration down there, and he managed to avoid hitting anything solid. Back out onto the racetrack he goes, and naturally, as you would expect, the caution flag and the pace car are now out on the racetrack. As we slow things down here, 85 laps into the Glass City 300 is where we are right now. There's another look at the three car of Yale Conley from Vienna, West Virginia. The racing surgeon, we have called him many times. And here's another look at just what happened. This is our finish line camera.
Speed shot off turn number four, and it looks like he simply lost it. You can see, I'm not sure who it was right behind him, but I don't think anybody made contact. And, you know, I expect to see that several times today. The track really flattens off coming off turn number four, and it's real easy to get away from you.
There's a look at Yale Conley circulating the track without any damage to his race car. We're going to take a cut away from the action. 86 laps are gone. A lot of them yet to come.
A safari rarely lasts longer than a few weeks. Unless it's a safari maintained with genuine AC oil filters. Because over hill, dale, and wadi, no other filter can track down, trap, and capture more dirt. So, AC oil filters keep your engine on the hunt for a longer life.
Call 1-800-AC-DELCO. It's like buying time.
When it's a matter of survival, it's AC filters.
One races, and you've got to believe you're going to win them all. Not one, not two, but every single one. So you better make sure you've got the best crew, the best car, and the best tires. Goodyear Eagles, made by people who want to win just as badly as you do.
Goodyear, number one in racing, number one in tires.
I've won 7 NASCAR championships with Goodyear. That ought to tell you something.
Everyone knows water and wax don't mix. Everyone's wrong. Introducing Wax Packs, a revolutionary car wax that disperses in soap and water to wax your car while you wash it.
I'm waxing.
New Wax Packs. Waxes while you wash.
This is Dale Jarrett's NASCAR. You can't get his engine, you can't get his tires, but you can get his motor oil. Mexico Haviland Formula 3. It's formulated to control volatility and fight oil vaporization. It provides complete protection, and it's the exact same Haviland you can buy right off the shelf, which, by the way, is a heck of a lot easier.
Add more life to your car. Take it to the star.
Today's cars are a technological wonder. So many makes, so many models, so many parts. In the old days, one standard part would fit many cars. Not anymore. The search for someone committed to having the part you need when you need it can be downright treacherous. You need auto parts specialists, like All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper. At All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper, auto parts are our business and our only business. The auto parts specialist. All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper.
Out there, all that matters is the challenge of the cast. The perfect presentation, the perfect lure. Then it happens. Reel in the magic, Saturday and Sundays on TNN Outdoors.
Timing is everything, and you're just in time for the green flag to come out here on lap 89 of 300 at the Toledo Speedway. Here in the Glass City 300, Mike Felder, number 18, the Tomato 18 out front with the Black 88 in second spot. J.D. Summers still doing a great job hanging on, one cylinder fewer than everyone else. To third place, although he is getting a heck of a challenge from Tony Raines in the 87 car. And what about Johnny Benson Jr.? Just patiently rolling along and riding back there in fifth place with Gary St. Amant sixth.
Well, I think anybody inside the top 15 or 20 at this juncture is just riding. You can see once again the field in single file order. They did say they weren't going to race for the first 50 laps or so, but again, with 28, 30 cars remain on the lead lap, it's going to become a racing strategy. Glenn Allen Jr. was back in the pits while we were under caution, now runs next to last of the 28 cars that still remain on the lead lap.
28 or 30. Now, Torch
okay,
has told us 28.
I know.
And the know-it-all brothers say 28. There's 28 cars
That's
on the
right.
lead lap.
That's right.
Our statistician is working hard up here for us, as always, keeping track of things. And as difficult as it is, we're happy to have those guys working for us. As we can keep track of the first and second place cars, that's about all I can handle. And I count on Rob for maybe third and tenth. And then we've got to go to the real experts.
Now you're looking again at the heated battle, third and fourth positions. J.D. Summers, who we continue to be told is down a cylinder, and if so, pretty amazing run for the young man from Michigan.
Well, maybe they don't need any more than five then. If that's the case, he's doing pretty good on five out there, the V6 engines. If he's down one, he's still doing a fine job. The race car setup and handling is so, so important on the track here. Apparently he has enough horsepower to keep the car pedaling around the track there, and it's the handling setup that he used, obviously, to his advantage, getting on the outside. He was a thousandth of a second slower than Mike Miller in qualifying, so even though he sat on the outside of the first row, it wasn't a whole lot of difference in qualifying between the pole sitter and J.D. Summers, who now runs third.
In fact, Brian, of the 47 cars, I think, that made qualifying runs, 35 of them qualified within four-tenths of a second of one another.
We've come to expect that in the AC Delco Challenge Series, America's Premier Short Track Series. And we're going to go once again down to Ralph with Mike Chaffee. Tire story is the issue of the day.
Well, actually, Brian, we want to talk to Mike Chaffee about why Jake Saunders running so well. He's really running great, Mike. Can he keep this pace up?
I think he can. Now, there's nobody in the business that's smoother, and he's just trying to save the right rear tire right now. And that all the other guys in front of him are just trying to burn him off the corner, and I think he's going to do a real good job for us.
You know, Jay, has been a controversy here last year at this race. Is he destined to try and upset that pad bar?
We don't really go into it aiming to do anything like that. We're trying to win every race, but I think we got a real good shot at it today.
Well, he's definitely charging to the front, gentlemen. One other note about Yale Conley. One reason why he might have lost on the front straightaway is he had lost his power steering early on, so he might have been fighting that wheel.
I find it interesting, Rob, that they mentioned that he was trying to save the right rear tire. Now, is that one, he's just more fond of that one than the others?
Well, of course, on a bank racetrack, you're always going to get more wear on the right side tires than the left side tires. And the right rear, depending on how you set the car up, if you like a car that is neutral or tends to push a little bit going into the corners, that throws more weight bias to the right front corner. Therefore, that's the one you have to be concerned about. If you like your race car a little bit loose, a little bit tail happy, then it's the right rear that tends to get the most abuse. So it just depends on what you as a driver prefer in terms of chassis setup. We've got 28 cars showing on the lead lap. Let's see if we can get through some of them as we watch this battle for the lead. Back in the pack, and I think that's about 9th, 10th, and 11th positions. Let's tell you, as Brian Reffner now goes by, or tries to go by, Tom Jones, right behind him is Steve Holzhausen in car number 78. Then it's Jay Sauter. And Jeff Neal, who started way, way deep in 34th position, the Lakeville, Illinois driver of the Pi Royal Splitfire All-City Chevrolet, has moved up now, Brian, to 11th spot. And he's done it very quietly.
Well, I got a couple of pieces of information about Jeff Neal. They came to the racetrack. Of course, Jeff qualified so well in Columbus. They came to the racetrack. They had some, as Jeff put it, experimental stuff that they tried out on the car, suspension parts, shocks, and things like that. On the drawing board, it looked good. On the racetrack, it was horrible. And he just said, we got out there in qualifying and just had no clue what we were trying to do. We kept trying to adjust things. It didn't work. finally, we just ended up putting the old stuff back on the race car, the tried and true suspension components that worked so well for us in Columbus, and we expect to make a run towards the front. Well, he's doing that from 34th up to, well, wherever he is right now. He's in 11th place. That's a pretty darn good run.
This is that continuing battle from 8th spot on back through about 14th. You can see Bob Seneca at the tail end of that frame in car 84. He dropped back early, and now he's beginning to pick his way a little slowly through the field and make his way back toward the front. Mike Miller, Mike Eddy, J.D. Summers, Tony Raines, and Johnny Benson are 1 through 5, 6 through 10. Gary St. Amant, Scott Hansen in car 53. Then it's Brian Reffner, Steve Holzhausen, and Jay Sauter. 11 through 15 is that Jeff Neal machine, 11. Matt Kenseth is 12th, Pat Bordeaux 13th, Dennis Lantman 14th, and Bob Seneca shown in 15th position, 16th through 20th. Dave Sensiba, Harold Fair, Brad Loney, the 07 of Todd Forbes, and then Bill Baird, who was involved in an incident in car number 26. 21st through 25th, the 05 machine of Matt Hutter, 56 Brett Bell, then Ted Smokestad, Rick Beebe, and Bobby Dodder in car number 08. Rounding up the cars on the lead lap are Todd Oliver, the 51 of Brandon Sperling, Joe Knott, and the last lead lap automobile at last count was Glenn Allen Jr. in car number 15. And we're kind of looking back in the pack. Since then, he's moved up a few spots, but is not that far in front of the leader. So that car is not running the way it was before that on-track incident.
Of course, since you got that list, the Bob Seneca has moved his car from 15th to 12th spot. He now sits right behind and just slightly outside of Jeff Neal, the 75. Let's go again to Ralph. This time, he's got the tire story.
Brian, as you know, Goodyear provides all the tires for the ASA competitors, and they do a tremendous job of tailoring the tires to the Civic racetrack. This weekend at Toledo, we got a bit of a different tire on the right side of the car. It's a softer compound tire, and it's about a half inch bigger than what we're running on the left side, which is also a little bit harder. That offsets that stagger a little bit, so there's stagger built into the tire automatically. They will also run this tire with about 10 pounds more air pressure than on the left. That increases that stagger even more. So there's about 2.5 inches difference in stagger between the right side and the left side of the ASA car here today.
Brian, we talked about that second groove. There are at least a couple of guys who've begun to make that work. As the yellow is displayed, we've got an incident on the backstretch involving the third place car of J.D. Summers.
22 car facing the wrong way in the middle of the backstretch there, and something went definitely amiss for J.D. Summer. We'll hopefully get a look at it, and we will cue up the replays. We will try to find what happened for you for the car of J.D. Summer. We also know that Tony Raines was involved, and we'll be back to show it to you right after this.
You know, a lot of people who work on their cars will only shop at AutoZone. They depend on us for the best quality parts and low prices every day. They come in, get what they need, and then get back to work. Because you see, they believe if you want the job done right, you do it yourself. Well, at AutoZone, we couldn't agree more. Because when you take the time and the effort to work on your car yourself, you ought to be choosy about where you shop. We just thank you for choosing AutoZone.
There was no mistake about it. I was definitely in cruiser heaven. Even my wife looked somehow different. And there I was prowling the streets on the new Kawasaki Vulcan 800. V-twin rumbling, chrome gleaming the sun. Is this for real? Or am I just dreaming?
The Vulcan 800 from Kawasaki. It's as real as it gets.
We're back to the Glass City 300 here in Toledo, Ohio, as the premier short track series in America resumes with an on-track incident that occurred just before the commercial break. They're cleaning up the last little bit of it. Here is a look from the backstretch.
And it looks like J.D. Summers is already sideways. It involved the third and fourth place cars. You can see Tony Raines has also sustained damage. He's been in the pits, lost a lap in the process of changing the right front corner. And you can see Johnny Benson and Gary St. Amant moving quickly to the outside of the racetrack.
There's Summers sliding towards the inside. It looked as though there was some damage to Raines' car as he was going by, so perhaps those two did get together. Here's a look from inside Tony Raines' car. And, well, there's J.D. Summers spinning out, and there's the hood. Okay, we just saw the hood buckle up a little bit there, so it looked like Tony tagged him on the way by as he was already sideways. Let's go down to Ralph.
Well, you're right about Tony Raines and J.D. getting together. Now, J.D. is in the pit. They got a lot of damage in this front nose. They're going to try, I guess, to belt it on. It looks like they should just rip it off, though. They are changing right side tires. They'll get around here and get him back out. And they really did not get the mud down at all, gentlemen. They're going to have to get him back in here probably and get that fixed. Tony Raines had problems, too, the right side of his car. He had suspension damage to the car and knocked the toe out on that machine. He's going to probably have to come back in there and square that back up.
The racetrack being cleaned up, the cars being repaired, and the racing itself will resume here shortly. While we've got a pause in the action here, it's a good time to show you our Young Racers feature for this week. Here's Josh Duvall.
Hi, I'm Josh Duvall. Welcome to the Young Racers. This week's question comes from Trey Ingram of Raleigh, North Carolina, and he wants to know how the ASA got started. So we went to its founder, Rex Robbins.
Josh, that's a good question. 28 years ago this month, May the 2nd, 1968, we ran our first sanctioned race. The sanctioning body was merely put together as a vehicle to promote and sanction races at one speedway, Sun Valley Speedway in Anderson. We had hoped to one day purchase that track. The first year, the owner decided not to sell the track, and we were stuck with the sanctioning body. We'd lost a lot of money in 1968, but in near the end of the season, we did do two 100-lap stock car races, and they turned out to be fairly successful. And I think we made maybe $300 or $400 on both of those races. So we talked ourselves into going one more year. And in 69, it turned around, and now 28 years later, we're here at Toledo Speedway with a $3 million series and a $500,000 point fund. So I guess we made the right decision.
Thank you, Mr. Robbins. If you have a question, write it down and send it to me at The Young Racers, P.O. Box 26792, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28221.
And after the incident on the racetrack involving the 22-car of J.D. Summers and the 87 of Tony Raines, some drivers opting to go into the pit, some not. And coming out really smelling like a rose on this deal is Jeff Neal, who started 34th, and now he's run himself up into second by a series of circumstances. The leader, Mike Miller, also did not pit. So they now run 1 and 2. Got a quick word about Jeff Neal. We were joking with him because he just had a horrible qualifying day. Didn't even think he was going to make the field. So I went down and, in an effort to lend a little levity to their very serious situation. I said, well, you know, the ASA has got that best-looking car rule that they can just put in the best-looking car that they like that didn't qualify. So you don't have any problem. You got a great-looking race car. You're in, Jeff.
That was pretty low. In fact, it was Todd Forbes in the Yoder Maisto Thunderbird that won the best-appearing car. And gorgeous paint job. Maybe we'll get to almost getting out of shape with Jeff Neal. We'd like to thank the folks from Maisto. We showed up here this weekend and mentioned them on the air last weekend. And I had a beautiful new die-cast Ferrari that I'm going to race against the one they gave you. And I'm going to blow your doors off.
Well, they gave you one of the model ones. They gave me a real one, man. I got an XJ220 Jag.
No way. Oh, I see it.
They're great looking cars. You'll see more of those little Maisto cars. Rob and I are going racing here later on this season with our Maisto 118 scale cars. Beautiful.
And Brian, suddenly Jeff Neal is going backwards in his race car number 75 inexplicably as Brad Loney comes off the track and right in front of us in car number 33. So that cracked header, apparently the problem is worsening for him. And there he is in that Winnebago H&W Flex Steel Chevrolet. Had such a great run a couple of weeks ago at Columbus and a great qualifying run yesterday.
Mike Miller to the left of the screen there still runs out in front. Second on the racetrack, Matt Kenseth, the number 68 machine. The Nielsen Racing Chevrolet. There he just comes into view.
And his car owner, Fred Nielsen, who used to field cars for Joe Scheer, racing veteran, is working hard at trying to put a sponsorship deal together that would bring Matt to this series as a Rookie of the Year contender. He's not officially signed for that, but boy, I'll tell you, if they're working with anybody specifically, this has got to be an encouragement to sponsor Kenseth as a rookie or prospective rookie. He's giving it quite a ride in second place.
Looking a little deeper in the field, there's Johnny Benson Jr. There's also the number 32 car of Ted Smokestad running just behind him. And this is in the middle of the bunch. The sixth car is there as well. Rick Beebe. Rick Beebe running one of two Chevrolet Monte Carlo bodies in the race. And on the outside, Tom Jones in the zero. Of course, he involved a little while ago. Has some damage to his race car. He's flipping around to the outside. But Johnny Benson Jr. charging up in the middle of the bunch right now. As Mike Miller continues to lead way out front. This is a race a little bit further back in the pack, specifically in something along the order of seventh and eighth spots.
I kind of predicted that Rick Beebe might be the favorite for Rookie of the Year. He's now sliding backward a little bit in the engine armor of Monte Carlo, but he's battling back now, failing to make the show after a flat tire and qualifying at Columbus a couple of weeks ago.
Let's go once again down inside the racetrack to Ralph Shaheen.
think is why Jeff Neal got loose out of the racetrack. Rear end grease coming out of the bottom side of Brad Loney's machine. Got the car loose on the racetrack. He gathered back up. Bad news for Brad Loney. His day is done.
Well, that's going to shake the point standings up quite a bit. Loney came in after a strong second-place run to Mike Eddy 2 weeks ago, a career-best finish. He'll drop well back now with an early exit from this race at lap 129.
There's Mike Miller out front still in the Atlanta Communications Pontiac. The pole sitter relinquished the lead early for just a few laps to J.D. Sommer, but he has retaken the lead and is in command of this one. We are approaching the halfway mark of the Glass City 300, and we'll continue when you come back.
Over the years, Little Caesars has run promotions with many of its neighbors. Two pizzas and a back rub. Two pizzas and a colorful fish. And some chattering teeth. And this thing. And one of our most popular, the perm.
I'll never top that one.
Finally, two pizzas and a movie.
Wow.
It's the Blockbuster Video Pizza Pizza Deal. Buy a top-of-the-line Little Caesars Pizza Specialty Pizza, a medium one-topping pizza, and get a free Blockbuster Video rental when you rent two.
Pizza Pizza.
Now at Pep Boys, get any four of our 35,000-mile all-season steel-belted tires at an incredible low $99.96. That's right, any size, any set of four, just $99.96 at Pep Boys now. No matter what you drive, Pep Boys Motor Oil meets or exceeds virtually all manufacturer's specifications. Now only 79 cents a quart, just $9.48 a case. That's right, 79 cents a quart, $9.48 a case, only at Pep Boys.
Shade Tree Mechanic, today on TNN. Due to live race coverage, Hank Parker's Outdoor Magazine will be presented at a different time. 4:30 p.m., 3:30 Central, today on TNN Outdoors.
Gardeners, if you love beautiful gardens full of garden fresh vegetables, big beautiful flowers and elegant landscape plantings, but hate the time and backbreaking work it takes, here's great news. Introducing the affordable Troy-Build Pony, designed and built especially for home gardeners. The Troy-Build Pony is an amazing time and work saver, turning any soil into perfect planting beds quickly and easily. Working rich organic matter into your soil, building exciting new flower gardens and border plantings. You can even reseed your lawn or dig a deep trench for planting shrubs. Plus, you'll love having your own garden fresh vegetables all season long. So if you want to learn more about getting results like this, the fast, easy Troy-Build way, call for your free catalog today. Call now and we'll also include complete details on our Troy-Build easy payment plan. For your free catalog featuring the pony and our whole line of Troy-Build tillers, including our no-money-down easy payment plan, call 1-800-847-9595. That's 1-800-847-9595. Call now.
America's premier short track series continues with the Glass City 300. We're 139 laps out of 300 down right now, and Mike Miller in the number 18 car out of Marietta, Georgia, continues to lead. There's a good look at the Tomato Red 18. A former Minnesota driver, a veteran of the American Speed Association, took about 10 years off until 3 years ago, came back racing like a youngster, he said. He's got a whole new lease on life, and after sitting on the pole here, I got to tell you, though, down in North Georgia, they don't say on the pole. He said they may set up poles up here, but down in North Georgia, we're on the stob, he said. They drive stobs in the ground, sledgehammers down there. We're on the stob, they say.
Well, let's leave it to those that are driving poles in the ground and calling poles on the racetrack. Johnny Benson has just taken fourth position away from Jeff Neal in car number 75. Now, I believe Benson has made a pit stop as Todd Forbes, who was running in fourth position, is off the pace, now comes on pit road. Mike Miller has not yet made a pit stop, Ryan, and you've got to be considering the fact he's now gone over 70 miles, and they normally think about 90, 100 miles is all you can go on fuel. He's going to need a caution pretty soon and some gasoline.
Well, I can also tell you that the crew, the Mike Miller crew, has been working very hard on their pit stops. And when they come in, they should be, if we can believe what they've been saying, they should be very fast in the pits, getting a couple of tires off and getting gas in the car. They've been running, as they put it, around 9 second pit stops, and that, as you know, is very fast.
Well, he continues to move away. We talked about those soft tires, but he must be really tiptoeing on the tires. There's Johnny Benson now closed up on the third place, car number 81 of Harold Fair, who's having a great run. Harold in that Alec Pinson-owned car, but Harold, of course, now is full-time racer. Started back at 25th in that Build-A-Mold Dana Racing Pontiac.
Dana Corporation, of course, one of their new sponsors this year is a company that owns a lot of brands that we see on the race car. The Dana Corporation folks have come on board with Carroll Fair and his operation and have really helped them step their program up a notch. Harold Fair, of course, one of the great veterans of racing, instead of being sort of a part-time racer, has now kind of gone to being a full-time guy, and that is, of course, what it takes to compete on this circuit. We talked to Harold about how it feels different to be a, quote, full-time racer.
My son and I are working at the shop. With Bobby coming on board, we may have more people coming in the shop, and we're going to run it as a business, and, you know, we're going to be serious about it. We're going to have fun at it, but we're going to work at it, and we're going to try to get things right. We were down here testing about a month ago, and we have both cars working pretty good, and I think over the course of the whole year, I think you're going to find our cars in the victory circle.
Up on the outside of turn number two, the 51 car of Brandon Sperling. I know it's tough finding a parking spot around the Toledo Speedway. That's not where you want to take it. We'll take a break and come right back.
Sleek, stunning lines, precise engineering, an innovative award-winning design, and a sporty power red finish. But we're not here to amaze you with its finish. We're here to amaze you with its start. Just pull the trigger, push the button, and you're trimming. No hassle, always easy. The revolutionary new Home Light push-button start trimmer. Sure, it's got a great finish, but you'll love it for its start.
Monroe developed SensiTrac shocks to smooth out the roads for a comfortable ride. But SensiTrac doesn't stop there. It's the only shock that also gives you extra control when you need it most. SensiTrac shocks and struts, only by Monroe. For comfort and control. Get SensiTrac shocks. Call 1-800-STRUT now for a Monroe ride expert near you.
Now at Pep Boys, get any four of our 35,000-mile all-season steel-belted tires at an incredible low $99.96. That's right, any size, any set of four, just $99.96 at Pep Boys now.
Head to Ace Hardware Maydays. They'll cover all your springtime needs. Plant some new ideas in your head with a steady flow of quality products, all at rock-bottom prices. Ace Maydays. Hurry in while it's in full bloom.
Welcome back, everybody, to the premier short track series in the country, the American Speed Association's AC Delco Challenge Series. And we are right dead center in the middle of 300 laps of racing here in the Glass City 300. And after the pit stops, we have a new leader. And the leader is number 84, and that is Bob Seneker, goes back out on the racetrack as the number one car on the top of the list. We also have joining us here in the booth, Brent Snelson, Director of Sales for AC Delco, their Consumer Relations Aftermarket Department. And welcome to the bird's nest here, Brent.
Thank you, Brian. Great to be here.
What do you think so far of what's going on out there? Another Toledo day, it looks like.
Well, yes. Let me first state it's a real pleasure for us to once again sponsor the ASA AC Delco Challenge Series. And this is why we're here. It is so exciting. And once again, beautiful day, and it looks like Bob's in the lead now.
Well, we've come to expect great racing here at Toledo. Certainly after last spring, things were very exciting indeed, and we were looking forward to coming back, and it's picked up right where it left off, I'd have to say, Rob.
Yeah, Brent, I did notice you didn't have much enthusiasm in your voice when you said Bob's in the lead now, since he's driving the car that has the blue oval on the front.
That's right. Mike was doing real well there in the number 88 car, and I don't know where he is now, but he's not number two like he was earlier.
And obviously, you've got some brand loyalty, but by the same token, Brent, I think this series has really epitomized brand equity because you've got the Ford of Bob Seneker leading, Mike Eddy perennially strong. You've got the Chevrolets of Brad Loney and Dave Sensabaugh, who earned Rookie of the Year last year. So parity is what it's all about. Competition is what it's all about, and that's that's what I've seen from you folks and your involvement with this series from the outset. And, you know, your goal is to see as competitive a racing as possible for the fans.
Yeah, that's exactly right. You know, the greater the awareness of our products and our services, the greater the equity, the brand equity, and hopefully that's a positive brand equity. And then, of course, that impacts preference and then purchase. In fact, we had just recently introduced the AC Rapid Fire Spark Plug. It's a performance spark plug, and we're in the process of selling that to many of our automotive retailers. One here locally, Murray's, I believe, will be advertising it next week. And then there's a number of our accounts, the Track Autos and AutoZone, and also Nationwide is going to be selling it shortly. So it's a real new product for us, and we feel that it's going to generate a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of sales.
Well, I'm sure that a lot of fans out there, looking for that little bit of extra performance, they'll certainly be looking for those on the shelves of their favorite auto parts store.
We're still under caution here on the racetrack, and just so you know, Brent, Mike Eddy came back. He's in eighth spot right now. Mike Miller, also in a Pontiac, who was the leader, has come back out onto the racetrack in fifth position. We're going to go real quick as we just went to green down to Ralph Shaheen in the infield. Now, some of the pit stops went relatively well, some not so well, Ralph.
Brian, watch this replay here for a second of what took place with J.D. Summers' car. You'll see this air gun come flying around from the back side and hit Zach Abraham right in the back. He's a little beat up right now, and he's going to go talk to the medical staff to see if he's okay. He said he really took a shot to the ribs. The gun came from Glenn Allen Jr.'s car. Zach Abraham a little beat up on pit stop.
Wow, I have never seen that, and I think one of those air guns weighs about 15 or 20 pounds, and that thing looked like it had been shot out of a cannon. It was a real shot. It'll be a sore pup tomorrow.
A lot of air pressure behind those things, and of course, they get away from you. As we look back out onto the racetrack, Bob Seneker in the number 84 is the leader, although he is physically behind Bobby Archer in the 93 car, the Build-A-Mold Triplast 2000 Pontiac teammate car of Harold Fair. And running down the list, in the second spot is the number 5 car, Brian Reffner. In third spot is the 4 car, Dave Sensaba. How many times have we seen those two guys last year at least running one right with the other?
Many.
Then it's the 78 car, sitting in fourth spot, Steve Holthaus, doing a very consistent job. Mike Miller's 11 seconds pit stop, got him back out in fifth place. And then it's the 21 of Johnny Benson, the 53 of Scott Hanson, the 88 of Mike Eddy, and the 68 car out there in ninth spot is Matt Kenseth. And Jeff Neal appears to have gotten all the grease off his tires, and he's running 10th right now.
Brent, I know we need to let you go, but before you go, I'd just like to ask you, I mean, it's already been a wonderful relationship between the American Speed Association and the GMSPO and the AC Delco folks. What do you envision for the future?
We're going to continue with our participation in motorsports and with the AC Delco Challenge Series. By the way, gentlemen, you're doing a great job for us. We appreciate it. And this is what it's all about. It's grassroots. It's excitement. And the fans keep coming out and keep buying our products as a result. So thank you once again.
Yeah, thank you.
Our pleasure. Our pleasure indeed, Rob Albright, as we look out onto the racetrack again. Things have shuffled up a little bit. They're different than they were, of course, before the pit stop. That's the way racing works. Some guys went in early. Now, we had questioned, of course, very early in the race when Brad Loney went in, but he went in because he had to, and he's now out of the race. Some guys pit a little earlier than others. They wait for those cautions. They play their cards the way they see them. Now, Mike Miller went a long way without going into the pits. When he finally did, he lost a few spots, of course, on the racetrack. And Bob Seneker, if you want to talk about another KG veteran, there's a guy out in front right now.
And he's easing away just a little bit from Brian Reffner. Here's the good battle. It's third through sixth positions. Dave Sensaba followed by Steve Holthausen. And then it is the car number 18 of Mike Miller and Johnny Benson Jr. Now, just a couple of minutes ago, Sensaba was really knocking on the back door of Brian Reffner. He's now fallen into the clutches of this more experienced trio of drivers. Benson, who had the engine problem yesterday and really battled out of the, battled from behind all day long, now has his car running well. Look at Mike Miller racing toward the front. A lot of the drivers will now have made a second pit stop and may have fresh sides and tires on both sides of the car. Miller just changed, I think, Brian, right side tires. He can only make two tire change stop under caution. And I think he probably now is prepared to go the distance if he needs to.
Well, you did say that it's the right side tires that take a beating. Those are the ones they changed. He worked on Steve Holthausen for a while and got through. Johnny Benson went with him, by the way. Now both of them have moved around the 78 car, and they're tucked up behind the number 4. Whoa, Johnny Benson a little later on the brakes than Mike Miller moved up close to him there. And now they're working on the four car of David Sensabaugh to head towards the front.
Just a couple hundred yards behind them are Mike Eddy and Scott Hansen, who also were on pit road, and they're beginning to close in as well. And look at Benson now, makes a bump on Mike Miller. And I think Miller knows that Benson really is not racing for points or a championship, but, you know, he's got honor at stake here. He was the 1993 champion, loved to come back and win against his old mates. And I think he's kind of saying to Miller, hey, you need to make a move because Seneca and Reffner are getting away.
Brad Loney coming back out of the pit after an extended pit stop. We saw the oil dripping out of the rear end. Ralph, got a comment about that?
No, perhaps not. Maybe we'll have Ralph in just a minute, but they will do whatever they can. If it's something that can be repaired on pit road, they'll repair it because points are paramount. Ralph?
Well, they got Brad Loney's car fixed and back out. Brett Bell is sitting here in the Wonder Bar Ford up on Jack's. Brett, what's wrong with your car?
Ford is running well today. Bird is out there trying to ride, and it looks like he got tangled up in the zero car there. Racing accident. We ended up breaking the right front shock, and it looks like we got some sort of fuel
delivery problem.
Chuck Jay from the Wonder Bar crew. Back up front on the racetrack, it is the 84 Bob Seneca running first spot with Brian Reffner in the black number five there, the structural transport Ford. So we've got a pair of teamers running up front right now. And then that great battle for third, fourth, and fifth is Dave Sensabaugh providing the front. And there it is, and Mike Miller trying to find a way around the four car. That's a Monte Carlo now, one of the two Monte Carlos on the racetrack. Dave Sensabaugh, the other being the six car of Rick Beebe. And they had said, both of them, both Rick Beebe and Dave Sensabaugh said that they experienced immediately much more downforce.
And Benson now,
car.
Brian, has moved to the low side of Mike Miller. He's forced the Pontiac up high. Benson is alongside, and he will take the fourth position away from Mike Miller.
Well, he was working pretty patiently on it. Let's see if he has any better luck with Dave Sensabaugh than Miller did. Sensabaugh now trying to get around the outside of the nine car of Dennis Lampman. So let's see if the 1993 ASA champion has any better luck trying to get around Dave Sensabaugh and head for the front.
It's an interesting pairing on the racetrack. Last year's Rookie of the Year battling against the 1990 Rookie of the Year, Johnny Benson Jr., who went on to win a championship in his fourth season. Sensabaugh, coming from the same area, the Grand Rapids, Michigan area, would love nothing better to follow in Benson's footsteps in ASA.
Well, and add to the list the pole sitter for the Glass City 300, Mike Miller in the 18, and the seven-time ASA champion, Mike Eddy, who has now made another appearance just off the rear bumper of the 18 car. Let's go once again down to Ralph Shaheen in the infield with Todd Forbes, who's out.
Well, the Mesa Ford is on the blocks. What's wrong with it?
Something went in the motor. I don't really know exactly. I think initially something went wrong with the carburetor, but I think we might have burned a piston cleaning it out.
Todd Forbes down here this afternoon to clean it.
Well, now, they got plenty of spare cars down there in the Forbes pit. They're not all ASA specifications, I don't think, and some of them might be a kind of a tight fit for Todd if he tried to climb inside those Maisto models.
I could loan him back my black Ferrari. That would definitely be a better choice than your Silver Jag.
Well, I don't know. The Silver Jag is at least the same color as the 07 car. Still looking at the 2 liters, Bob Seneca number 84 and Brian Reffner in the black number 5, and one of our cameramen, the crowd here in Toledo, and we'll be right back.
Every day, we all find a way.
A promise made.
America's most complete source of auto parts, a national warranty program, and customer service only NAPA can give. No wonder more people trust NAPA to keep their vehicles running.
We keep America running. We keep America running.
Fact. Over 800,000 automobile crashes occur in the rain each year. Fact. The Subaru Legacy is equipped with all-wheel drive, the ultimate safety feature. Fact. Compared to front-wheel drive, the Subaru all-wheel drive system provides the driver with superior control and better handling on rain-slick surfaces. A fact that's very comforting indeed. Now buy a new Legacy with 1.9% financing or lease for just $199 a month.
There was no mistake about it. I was definitely in cruiser heaven. Even my wife looked somehow different. And there I was prowling the streets. twin rumbling, chrome gleaming in the sun. Is this for real, or am I just dreaming?
The Vulcan 800 from Kawasaki. It's as real as it gets. Roland Martin, world-class angler, trying his luck in the TNN Bass Tournament of Champions on Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis.
Wow, you know, this is the best fishing game going. And now we're offering you some chances to compete and win some great prizes, just like the pros, but right at home on Super Nintendo or Sega.
It's the TNN Bass Tournament of Champions contest. The grand prize is two Tracker Bass boats. 50 first prize winners will receive Team Daiwa reels. Other prizes include Lowrance fish finders, Bass Pro Shop gift certificates, and more. It's a tournament that you can start whenever you want. Once you've got your best catch, just take a photo of the screen that shows your catch's total weight.
Just like in a real tournament, the best catch wins the grand prize.
For complete contest rules, send a self-addressed envelope to this address. Or call 612-467-1400. Or look for the display at your local participating retail outlet.
Now, Ron!
Wow, get dark!
Welcome back, everybody, to Toledo and the Glass City 300. America's premier short track series continues with Bob Seneca running out in front along with Brian Reffner. Those two guys running scared because, man, I mean to tell you, there is a herd on their heels if they can just get untangled from each other. This race right here, Dave Sensima, Johnny Benson Jr., Mike Miller and Mike Eddy all fighting over the honor of who's going to head towards the two leaders once they get themselves sorted out, Rob.
And stacked right behind them are the rest of the thundering herd of Scott Hansen in car number 53, then Steve Holtzhausen, Matt Kenseth, Gary St. Amant, and Jeff Neal who battle for position. There's the top 10. You can see Kenseth and Neal rounding out the top 10. Going by the number 98 of Ken Stauffer. And as we watch this battle for fourth position, got to look at some incident that occurred a little bit ago between Dave Sensima and Johnny Benson as Sensima trying to go to the low side of Tom Jones and Benson trying to go even lower. And if there's a guy that Benson doesn't want to be responsible for taking out of a race, it's his fellow Grand Rapids area driver, Dave Sensima. And he did get out of the throttle and allow Dave to get squared away before again challenging him.
Sensima probably pretty happy for that extra little bit of downforce on the tail end of that Monte Carlo body, too, keeping the rear of that race car stuck on the track. Here's Benson on the low side. He makes it work this time, and now he finds in front of him the 26 car, Bill Baird, but he makes the pass. Baird staying down low, Benson going high. Mike Miller also nudging around the inside, and here's a race for the lead as Seneca tries to go around the outside of the 32 car there of Ted Smokestad. That is the Super America entry, and stuck inside now is Reffner.
Although Reffner does have the preferred line, Smokestad moves just enough ahead of him to give Reffner enough space to make the pass and take the lead away from Seneca. With about 100 laps to go, and Brian has just been, whoa, as he gets a little bit loose coming off turn number four.
Simultaneous moves going on there now as Reffner takes the lead. He's still trying to find a way around Smokestad's number 32 car, aerodynamically challenged by the lack of a hood.
You got to come up with a new phrase. That was good, but you need a new one.
Okay.
That's your assignment.
Oh, look at this now. Mike Miller slowing dramatically as Mike Eddy just shot around on the inside there. I'm not sure. It looked like Miller might have let it go.
I think Mike Eddy might have bumped it just enough to get the number 18 unsettled, and it allowed Eddy to make the pass.
Not Mike Eddy.
Well, I mean, it wasn't anything real blatant or intentional, but he had been running behind him for quite a while.
Ralph, got anything to say down there?
Well, most of the leaders got good gas, fuel mileage, and so forth early on, but they all figure they're going to have to stop but one more time before this race is over. They think they probably can go the distance on tires, but they will take tires when they come in for that extra fuel.
So we'll be watching and waiting for that and see how the strategies play out here as we continue to watch along with these folks. They're on the edge of their seat. They bought the whole thing. They're only using a little bit. We'll be right back.
This is Dale Jarrett's NASCAR. You can't get his engine. You can't get his tires. But you can get his motor oil. Texaco Haviland Formula 3. It's formulated to control volatility and fight oil vaporization. It provides complete protection, and it's the exact same Haviland you can buy right off the shelf, which, by the way, is a heck of a lot easier.
Add more life to your car. Take it to the star.
Well, the battery's good, and the starter's brand new, so I figure it's got to be the alternator, right?
I'll go into the AutoZone, get a new one. Well, this guy says, well, let's check the old one first. No sense buying something you may not need. Well, turns out it's a voltage regulator. I tell you, I could have spent a lot of time swapping out parts until I got it right. But with AutoZone, piece of cake.
If you ever wanted to be a young racer, it's easy. If you have a question about racing your favorite driver, write it down on a card and send it to me. We'll have one of our drivers and officials answer for you on the air. If your question is selected, we'll send you a nifty racing hat and t-shirt. So send your questions to Young Racers, P.O. Box 26792, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28221.
There's the 32 car of Ted Smokestad. It was missing a hood a while ago. Rob doesn't like aerodynamically challenged. Well, how about suspension prohibited? Is he missing the right front tire?
Okay, as Ted has climbed out of his car and this rookie driver moving around to the right-hand side to take a look, here's a replay. It was Brian Reffner trying to put a lap on Smokestad. And remember, Smokestad is the one that allowed Reffner to take over the lead, gets into him just a little too hard, and Smokestad into the outside retaining wall. Pops that tire like a grape and does some pretty significant damage to the right front suspension. We'll get another angle from our speed shot off turn number four coming up in just a second.
Now try to imagine the pucker factor for Bob Seneker. Watch this in the blue 84. Oh, coming right at you. Now a lot of people in the pits right now, and Mike Miller's went up and down, changed the two inside tires, got gas and shot back out onto the racetrack, so he's now changed the two tires that you said. And here's another look at this. As Reffner just trying to find a way around, Smokestad gets sideways one way, then the other. Reffner hard on the brakes.
You know, Ted almost saved it. You could see that, Brian. And Reffner did get out of the throttle to allow Ted an opportunity to get the car squared away. He just simply overcorrected, it looked like, which is the natural reflex response. When you feel the tail coming out, the natural reaction is to crank that steering wheel to the right, and that immediately turns that nose to the outside retaining wall. I'm sure Ted's not happy with the result, but a pretty interesting incident. Ralph?
Well, as you guys pointed out, everybody did pit the second half of the field in here now, taking on fuel and tires. So one thing to take note of is that Mike Miller changed left side tires while everybody else changed right side tires. Everybody did get all the fuel that they need to go the distance now, and they'll head back out. Brandon Sperling's car having some problems down the pit road here, the number 51.
But not everybody, in fact, did pit, Ralph. We see that Mike Eddy, Scott Hansen, Matt Kenseth, and Glenn Allen Jr. all stayed on the racetrack. And they may be in the catbird seat with less than 100 laps to go.
Well, we'll try to answer that question, hypothetically at least. Can the tires go the distance? Will the guys that didn't come in need to do so before the end of this one? We'll find out in a moment.
Now at Pep Boys, get any four of our 35,000-mile all-season steel-belted tires at an incredible low $99.96. That's right, any size, any set of four, just $99.96 at Pep Boys now. 49 cents. Not a lot to pay for quality. Now at Pep Boys, Champions Spark Plugs just 49 cents after mail-in rebate. That's right, Champion Plugs just 49 cents at Pep Boys now.
Work boots. There's one place they don't work. Inside, they just don't have much cushioning. Dr. Scholl's Maximum Comfort work insoles give you 100% more cushioning. They make work easier on your feet.
Come on and throw away your troubles, Captain, to the moon. And sell all your worries for free. For there's a great day coming. Can't you hear them all hollering? It's a cowboy jubilee. If you've got lots of leisure time and nothing else to do, and want to be happy as we, just grab your hat and get your boots on. Pretty soon you'll be long gone to the cowboy jubilee.
Championship Rodeo on TNN tonight.
Unbelievable.
Spectacular.
Breathtaking.
Crash.
Impact.
60 minutes of blazing crash action in this special edition two-volume set. See outrageous motocross and road racing action. Sprint cars and outlaws. Grand Prix.
Stock cars, monster trucks, powerboats, and more. Only $19.95.
This exclusive two-tape set is jam-packed with magnificent racing and crash action footage featuring top drivers from around the world.
Order now and get absolutely free.
Havoc 1, over 45 minutes of rare footage, including some of the most thrilling and horrifying moments that made early racing history. You'll get this incredible two-tape offer, plus your Havoc video free. Three tapes that'll blow you away. Guaranteed or your money back.
To order, call 1-800-544-6664. That's 1-800-544-6664. Or send payment to Crash Impact, P.O. Box 8435, Springfield, Missouri, 65801.
Welcome back, everybody. We're in the final 100 laps of the race. Here is Brian Reffner coming out of the pit area. He was assessed a stop-and-go penalty for the incident with Ted Smokestad, Rod.
Well, that's always a judgment call. The ASA officials apparently feeling that it was maybe a little more aggressive than he needed to be and decided to penalize a second-year driver. We don't think he was penalized for the whole lap. Being told it was just a stop-and-go penalty, and if there's any change to that, we'll update you.
After a series of pit stops, things have changed as you might expect, and as you might expect, guess who? Up front, the Black 88. Yeah, Mojo's working again.
But I got to tell you something. Now, less than 100 laps to go, I picked, before this race, I had to submit a column for the ASA Action Line, the publication of ASA, and I predicted Scott Hansen and Glenn Allen Jr., one of the two of them, would win the race. Hey, they're in second and fourth right now. Maybe I'll do okay on that.
Well, you do know something about this, apparently.
Well, you don't always seem to think so, but thank you for that little acknowledgement. I appreciate it.
I always think so. I'm just never sure.
Thank you.
There's a very subtle difference there.
And here are now a bunch of cars that did come on pit road, including Pat Bordeaux, who's still on the lead lap. Brad Loney is fast. He's just moving to the bottom to give these guys room because he's 47 laps down. Bob Seneca, Mike Miller, Gary Cinnamon all now have to hustle as 90 laps remain. Now, that may sound like a long time, but if we now would go an extended period under green, these guys have no chance to wait. Now, you can see Johnny Benson got bumped in the back end by, I'm not sure who, I think that's Harold Fair directly behind him. No, that's Jay Sauter. They are really racing in a tight pack.
A very tight pack. While out in front, Mike Eddy is trying to put some distance between himself and the field. Of course, everybody else would love nothing better than to see another caution come out and close things up a little bit. But at the moment, Mike Eddy outdistancing the bunch. Scott Hansen can't keep up. Glenn Allen Jr. is missing the hood on his race car. That cannot be a good thing. And even though he's running in third spot, is really having trouble closing any ground on the Black 88.
And this battle that we're looking at, I believe, is for like 6th, 7th, and 8th positions, and all the way back through about 20th. This last count, we saw 20 cars on the lead lap.
Well, we're showing Bob Seneca in 7th place, so then Gary St. Amant is one spot behind him. Pat Bordeaux, Mike Miller, and Johnny Benson Jr., Jay Sauter. That's the cluster starting at about 7th spot with Bob Seneca in the blue 84.
Rick Beebe right behind Jay Sauter in, I think, 10th position. Car number 6 having a good run in that engine armor machine.
Showing Bob Seneca in 6th place now. So that is where that battle is going on behind the leaders led, and the leaders being led by Mike Eddy.
Joe Knott has moved into 4th position. He got around Matt Kenseth, and he had a 7th place run at Columbus in the opening run of the season. Look at Benson, and it's apparent that Benson and Mike Miller both have faster cars, a little faster at least, than Pat Bordeaux's BASF rookie machine. But Pat holding his own against these more experienced drivers.
Now there's a good look, all alone, and he certainly is all alone on the racetrack right now at Mike Eddy, the 7-time American Speed Association champion, a man who is running neck and neck with his so-called Goodwrench teammate Dale Earnhardt for an unprecedented 8th championship. Why has this man never gone down south? We asked him.
This is the type of racing I do, and I enjoy doing it. And there's more to racing than just driving the car on Sunday for me. I like to work on my own stuff and prepare my own stuff. And I guess I'm just happy doing what I'm doing, and this is what I enjoy doing.
You know, make no bones about it. He has had numerous offers to go drive 4 teams down in NASCAR, but he has steadfastly refused to do it because he is a man that likes to call his own shots and run his own operation. And he's doing exactly what he wants to do, doing it quite well. As we look at this battle now heating up for second position.
Well, like Mike Eddy or not, you certainly have to respect a man doing what he wants to do. And it doesn't matter what that is. If the guy's doing exactly what he wants to do, you got to respect that. I'm doing exactly what I want to do, sitting right here in the booth watching this ASA race.
I don't know if you saw that. Glenn Allen Jr. raised a hand to Scott Hansen to say thank you for giving me racing room. It was these two guys who were battling for the win here last year, Brian, when they got into the oil of a car that had lost the engine in it, and they both went crashing into the wall. Now it will be Glenn Allen Jr., who we had maybe written off early in the going with all the damage that he had to this Eaglewood Construction CarQuest Pontiac, and now he will set sail for leader Mike Eddy.
There was a third victim in that very same incident. It was Johnny Benson Jr. all went spiraling into the wall after, I think it was Joe Knott, lost an engine, dropped some oil or some transmission fluid or something they didn't see. Everybody went spiraling away and racing for the lead last year. That was just one of the many things that made it an exciting event from our point of view anyway. There is Mike Eddy leading on the racetrack. Let's go once again down inside to Ralph Shaheen.
I'm with Howard Thomas, crew chief for Mike Eddy. Howard, you guys stay down. How much of a gamble is that here at Toledo with 100 to go?
Well, the tire wear is not real bad. So rather than go to the back again, we just took a chance.
And you're okay with your fuel?
Yeah, we can make it with fuel, no problem.
And I'll tell it to Mike Eddy.
There you heard it from Howard, the crew chief there. Howdy Thomas, of course, a lot of folks call him around here. And they've made a calculated gamble. They think the tires will last, and they know they have enough gas. We'll just have to watch and wait and see. Certainly running hard up front right now. Here's the battle for fifth as Bob Seneker is nudging his way towards the front, taking Gary St. Amant with it. These two guys racing pretty hard. We just saw a peek there at the Valvoline hood of the 48 car of Joe Knott. Kidded him earlier about borrowing a hood from Mark Martin to see if his car would go any faster. The fact is they've got a new sponsor on their race car, the 48 of Joe Knott.
Is that battle for fifth and sixth positions between Bob Seneker, who led for a while earlier, and Gary St. Amant's wins for car number seven, who's just having another consistent run today.
A lot of the veteran drivers and a mix of the young lions still doing battle here in the Glass City 300. Hi there! We'll be right back.
Vitamins do for your body, VitaWinds does for your car.
How to achieve success.
For me, it's the details. In golf, that means taking it one stroke at a time. And at Jiffy Lube, we do it one car at a time. And we offer the quality of Pennzoil. So even though we've serviced almost 100 million cars, the one that matters most is the one we're working on now.
If it doesn't say Jiffy Lube, it just isn't Jiffy Lube.
Today's cars are a technological wonder. So many makes, so many models, so many parts. In the old days, one standard part would fit many cars. Not anymore. The search for someone committed to having the part you need when you need it can be downright treacherous. You need auto parts specialists, like All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper. At All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper, auto parts are our business and our only business. The auto parts specialist. All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper.
Hi, I'm Rick Benjamin. On the PM edition of Race Day this week, we'll have all the highlights from the left and right turn course in Sonoma. We'll tell you who the winners were in sprint cars, super trucks, and road racing, too, on the PM edition of Race Day this Sunday.
All you need to know about motorsports. Race Day. Tonight, 7:30 p.m., 6:30 Central. Only on TNN Motorsports.
How would you like to really be part of the race team? Well, Racing Electronics, the official communications equipment supplier to the American Speed Association, is giving away a unit and Bearcat scanner along with a one-year racer frequency membership on each ASA telecast on TNN. To enter the drawing, send your name and address on a postcard to Racing Electronics, Box GFS, 8701 Mallard Creek Road, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28262. This week's winner is John Kahn from Muncie, Indiana. Congratulations, John. Enjoy your scanner.
Glenn Allen chases Mike Eddy. We'd like to extend some prayers and condolences to some folks, some of whom are at home this weekend. Gary Donegan, who's on the Tony Raines team. His dad has been ill. We wish him a speedy recovery. It's been kind of a mixed week for Kent Stauffer. He got a new sponsor this weekend, Popa Joe's Pizza, who he hopes is really going to be a big sponsor for the future. It's a frozen foods and pizza folks and some pocket sandwiches and that kind of thing. So they'll have a greater involvement. But Kent also lost one of his best friends, Tim Rule, this weekend in an accident, and our prayers go out to that family. Race Gilman, who was supposed to race here this weekend, his dad sustained a heart attack. He's not here. And a fellow named Cooper, who works on the crew of Bill Baird, his dad passed away, so he wasn't able to join us either. So again, our prayers and condolences to those folks and those that are ill. We wish them a speedy recovery. Back to ASA Racing.
We mentioned earlier in the broadcast there are a couple of brand new Monte Carlo bodies on the race cars out there, specifically the six that you're looking at right here. That's the car of Rick Beebe and also the four of Dave Sensima. Ralph Shaheen down in the infield has an update on the new Chevys.
Brian, if you're wondering why we only have two as you're sitting there at home, it's because Five Star, the company that produces the bodies, has been a little slow in getting them all out to the competitors. With the new Monte Carlos coming out this year, they've been real busy trying to get them made as quickly as they can. The bodies are all made out of fiberglass, so it takes a while for the company to produce them. If you're wondering why only one company produces the bodies, ASA did that on purpose. This way, all the Monte Carlos will look the same, which is great for the manufacturers, and it's great for the competitors. Nobody gets an advantage. And because they're fiberglass, they're a little bit cheaper for the competitors to purchase. Now, a lot of the teams have gotten them. They didn't want to run them at Toledo and Columbus because these are two tracks that are notorious for tearing up body panels. We'll probably see a lot more of them at IRP in the next round.
That's Rick Beebe working on the 22 car there. Rick Beebe in the Monte Carlo Chevrolet. His car is looking pretty good. On the other hand, J.D. Summers, who had sat outside the first row, his car cosmetically challenged at the moment as Mike Eddy, the leader in this race, starts to get into the traffic a little bit. As there's Dr. Yale Conley, who was involved earlier in an incident, moving down low. Mike Eddy trying to get around the outside of the racing surgeon from West Virginia. And Yale's giving a little bit of a run at it there.
Yeah, he is. But the next car to go lap down is the young man who was leading this race just a few moments ago, Brian Reffner. You can see that that outside groove is just a little treacherous as Mike tiptoes around the high side of Dr. Conley. Quite a while to make the pass. Glenn Allen tried to use that to his advantage to close. He was narrowing the gap significantly for a while, but it's almost as if Howdy Thomas, crew chief for Mike Eddy, said, look in your rearview mirror. Because just as quickly as Glenn was reeling him in, he now is falling back. And I'm wondering if there might not be another problem in the offing for Glenn Allen Jr. He's losing ground to Brad Loney, who's 47 laps down, but is as fast right now as just about anybody on the racetrack.
Well, Brad Loney racing for pride here. Loney hoping to, was, as he came into this race, hoping to keep alive a streak of high finishes. He's been in the top 10 in every ASA race since Milwaukee last year. And, of course, he was second 2 weeks ago in Columbus, third in the final race of 94, but that streak, as many of them do, came to an end.
Glenn Allen Jr., well off the pace off turn number two. Watch that car climb the banking. I think he may have a tire going down. He's trying to nurse it around, hoping for another caution. Let's take a peek as he goes by the start-finish line very, very slowly as he looked to be in a position to challenge for a possible win. And the third-place car of Scott Hansen is right there and about to make the move by.
Yes, Glenn Allen Jr., very tentative in that 15 car now. He's got something that he does not like at all. And let's go down to Ralph Shaheen, the man who knows.
Yeah, it's a flat right front tire, and that's not a lot of fun for anybody. The crew is down here waiting. They got the jack, they got the air guns, and they got a new right front. As soon as little Glenn decides he's had enough.
Well, no doubt, Ralph, he will stay out as long as he possibly can. He'll stay out praying for a yellow. If it does not come and he sees number 88 right behind him, he will definitely bring that machine on pit road. Again, he likes to go past the entrance to pit road, and he'll keep that machine out again with his fingers crossed that somebody else will bring out a caution in the next lap or two.
That's the 15 car right there that we're referring to. Glenn Allen Jr. from Grand Rapids, Michigan, of the Eaglewood Construction Park West Pontiac. Fingers crossed as he's providing a rolling roadblock for a lot of the traffic, but he's doing a great job of staying in the middle of the track, letting them pick their high side or low side, however they want to go around. Here's Mike Eddy in the 88. We're 47 laps from the finish of this race, and now Mike Eddy running into a little roadblock of his own there with a couple of cars. First Brian Reffner, then ahead of him, number 68. So Eddy experiencing his trouble in traffic. Back in second spot right now, Mike Miller has made a brilliant run towards the front after a pit stop to get left side tires. He got around Bob Seneca finally, and he's trying to find the number 88, who's about a quarter lap, maybe a third of a lap ahead of him right now.
And Scott Hansen was second as Glenn Allen has brought it on pit road, and Ralph is there.
The Glenn Allen car goes up in the air. They will change that right front tire, and it looks like they're going to change the right rear as well since they're in. A little slow with the right rear, and as soon as they get the car back down in the Honda Jack, Glenn Allen Jr. will return.
Here's Mike Miller working on the 48 of Joe Knott now. Gabe showed him a little bit on the low side and now tries to work it around the high side. Seneca, who's behind Mike Miller, had been in front of him, and Miller has gotten around. The pole sitter has been as far down in the standings as 10th when he came in for pits. He's had two very fast pit stops and is back out on the track with a very fast race car. Question is, with only 44 laps to go, does he have enough of a fast race car to make up about a third of a lap on Mike Eddy, the race leader?
But it's been a great run for Joe Knott, the youngster from Ohio, now moved to Grand Rapids, has taken the crew chief away from Glenn Allen Jr., Chris Bradley, who previously worked with car number 21, Johnny Benson.
Here's a lap ago as Mike Miller tried to get down on the low side of Joe Knott there, giving him a little smooch on the left inside, and Joe Knott keeping the car together. Mike Miller not able to get by that time. The next time around, he faked low, went high, and made the pass.
It just shows you what a couple of years' experience will do. Joe Knott, the exact same situation that Ted Smokestad was a little bit earlier when Brian Reffner was behind him, but not maybe just a few more laps on this racetrack, and he was able to correct without turning that nose into the outside retaining wall.
Ralph Shaheen has another angle on the Mike Miller story.
Well, Brian, he's doing a beautiful job of keeping that 18 under control. It's loosening up on him as everybody sets their cars up tight for this racetrack because the track gets slicker as the day goes on. And Mike Miller has really got the rear end hanging out on that car, especially coming off of turn four. We're seeing a lot of the other drivers suffering the same problem, but it's more and more apparent on the 18.
Well, Mike Miller working on the 93 car there, also the 54. He's made it good on both of those guys, working his way through traffic, trying to find the tail end of the 88. Loose car or not, Mike Miller driving the wheels off this Atlanta Communications Pontiac right now. The pole sitter had a fast car from the very minute it came off the trailer, and he's still got a fast car right here when it counts.
He needs to just pace himself, though, Brian. He'll never catch it. He'll never run him down if we stay green because he's a half lap behind. He can just simply hope for another caution and a shot at him. As a result, he might as well just hang tough in second position and save those right side tires as best he can and hope for that caution.
Well, hoping for a caution is something that doesn't always pay off. These folks here are settling in for what looks like it's going to be a great finish. Maybe we will get a caution, maybe we won't. In any case, we'll be right back.
It isn't easy winning a championship. One week you're on a super speedway, the next week you're on a short track, or a road course, or something in between. You have to change, you have to adapt, and you have to have the consistency and the technology of Goodyear Eagle Tires.
Goodyear, number one in racing, number one in tires.
Winning the championship takes consistency, and that takes Goodyear.
Today's cars are a technological wonder. So many makes, so many models, so many parts. In the old days, one standard part would fit many cars. Not anymore. The search for someone committed to having the part you need when you need it can be downright treacherous. You need auto parts specialists, like All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper. At All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper, auto parts are our business and our only business. The auto parts specialist, All-Pro and Bumper to Bumper.
The monster of Superlines unleashes the Mist Spider-Cat Superline Series. Spectra composite rod. Tangle reach. Titanium nitride guides. And powerful Mitchell reel with crossweb line wrap. The Mitchell Spider-Cat Superline Series. Don't get caught without it.
Head to Ace Hardware Mayday. They'll cover all your springtime needs and plant some new ideas in your head with a steady flow of quality products, all at rock-bottom prices. Ace Mayday. Hurry in while it's in full bloom.
I thought I was smart. I paid less for another protectant. It said it shined like Armor-All, so I figured it protected like Armor-All, too. But it didn't.
Armor-All provides superior protection against car vinyl discoloration.
For this, baby, I'm only using Armor-All.
Sometimes winning isn't pretty. Just ask Hermie Sadler.
Last year, Herbie Sadler dominated all day long, but with seven laps left, everything changed. Sadler's fuel-thirsty Chevy coasted to a stop and opened the door for Derek Cope, who outdueled Bobby Dotter and claimed the victory. It's Busch Grand National Racing from New Hampshire. The New England Chevy Dealers 250, Saturday, 1 p.m. noon central on TNN Motorsports.
Now that's racing.
You've got a front row seat for the final 28 laps of the Glass City 300 here. Hope you got your earplugs in. And we are set for a great finish. There's Mike Eddy still working his way through the traffic and some quarter lap or so behind him, Mike Miller trying to catch him.
He's definitely closing, but I think Eddy may be going easy on the tires at this point. There's the top five, Mike Eddy, Mike Miller, Joe Knott hanging on to third ahead of Bob Seneker. And look at Glenn Allen after having to make that pit stop. He'd like to make up at least one lap. Scott Hansen just lost six spots to Rick Beebe, then Gary St. Amant, Steve Holtzhausen, and Dave Sentiva rounding out the top ten.
Well, as you correctly put it, if they stay green, it's going to be very difficult for Mike Miller to make up any ground on Mike Eddy. Here's the battle for third right now is Joe Knott with that brand new hood on his race car, the familiar V of Valvoline, and Bob Seneker, who was passed earlier by Mike Miller, the spot that he's now racing for. 25 laps to go. You see it on your screen. You're watching a race for third. And the two cars in front are the 88 of Mike Eddy and the 18 of Mike Miller, the pole sitter.
Hey, the guy on the move, though, is the one at the end of that four-car freight train, Rick Beebe in car number six. We've talked about him just periodically. He has run these guys down in the last five or six laps from about half a straightaway back.
Well, the next guy he's got to work on is Johnny Benson Jr. There you see Beebe trying on the inside. Johnny Benson drifting up just a little bit, but not letting him by. Got loose for just a moment. So now Johnny Benson Jr., the 1993 AFA champion, busying himself with a hard-charging Rick Beebe coming up from behind in his engine armor Chevrolet Monte Carlo. We mentioned before, one of only two of the new Monte Carlo bodies on the American Speed Association circuit this week.
And Beebe with the crew chief, Dennis Grossnickel, that turned the wrenches for Mike Miller a season ago.
Well, and Dennis Grossnickel, I talked to him beforehand, and he said, you know, kind of a funny thing. He said, well, on the serious side, first of all, we noticed as when we got this race car out on the track that it had a lot more downforce, and we had to stiffen up the springs right away. But he said, the funny thing is, I went to pick up the car, and we got little stops in the trailer so that we know how far to push the car in. So we pushed the car in up to the stops, and I couldn't get the door closed because it's so much longer in the back. I had to go crawl up underneath the car and take the stops off the floor so we could close the door.
Joe Knott, who finished seventh a couple of weeks ago in Columbus, continues to fend off the challenge of Bob Seneker, but not having as much success as Johnny Benson as he gives way to the rookie, Rick Beebe. Now, we call him a rookie because he is, in fact, an ASA rookie, but the driver from Marion, Kansas, has a lot of experience and lots of wins in the Midwest, and a number of them came at I-70 Speedway, a place where we'll go in just a couple of weeks, a track similar in configuration and speed to the Toledo half mile.
Also see in the picture there Jeff Neal in the 75 car, the Splitfire entry, the car roll Splitfire also the Chevrolet. He's down, however, a lap and in 15th spot according to our scoring right now. So he had some troubles early on that he was not able to fully recover from. Jeff Neal had a great run early in this race, though, coming all the way from 34th to as high as second in the race. We are still looking for a yellow flag. Of course, even if we get it here in the American Speed Association, they will race five laps under green. So no matter if we do get a caution late in the race, we will still see a race under green to the checkered flag. Right now, we're still green with Mike Eddy out in front. Joe Knott here trying to hold off Bob Seneker. That is the race for third, as we mentioned before. And there's the leader once again putting yet another lap on early leader, number 22, J.D. Summers.
And right in front of Mike Eddy is Glenn Allen Jr. He did get one of his laps back just a couple of moments ago. 11 cars is all we're showing now, Brian, on the lead lap. And that's what happens. You know, you get to the midpoint, there's about 25 and 100 laps later, and there's only 11 cars on the lead lap.
Scoring is showing Glenn Allen Jr. in 20th place right now.
Take a look at the gap now between leader Mike Eddy. There he is, just out of screen. And where's the second place car? Mike Miller has definitely made up about a quarter of the half lap, or about a quarter of a lap at the half lap that he was behind. But again, he's still going to need that miracle of a final caution flag.
About 3 seconds on the racetrack. For those of you at home that understand what 3 seconds is, an eternity when you're trying to make it up on a guy that's going just about as fast as you are. So Mike Eddy can afford to soft pedal around just a little bit there. Keep an eye about one, two, three, four, fifth car back from him right now.
So Mike Miller, and we've got Rick Miller hard into the wall, and here is exactly what Mike Miller was looking for. Unfortunately, there will be about five cars, lap machines, between himself and Mike Eddy, but this may be just the final opportunity that he might need.
Now, these guys aren't related, are they, Rob? You don't know about that, are they? Rick Miller, Mike Miller, could be some... No, I'm sure they're not.
No, one's from Atlanta, Georgia, and the other one's from Pennsylvania.
I've always played the devil's advocate. In fact, they are not related. Rick Miller, one of the 11 rookie drivers that qualified for this race. He is out of Dunbar, Pennsylvania, as we mentioned, in the Extrude Home Power Flow Chevrolet. He has provided through no particular set of circumstances other than bad luck the opportunity that we have sort of hoped for, not even secretly, and that is to see a race of the checkered flag between two cars that are right very close together on the track. Now, there are, I believe, three cars in between the leader, Mike Eddy, and fifth on the track, but second place, Mike Miller, right now as we get ready to go back to green here for the tail end of this one.
289 laps of 300 in the record books as the track crew will now go quickly to the scene of Rick Miller's disabled car number 31, an ASA official pulling the hood pins, getting it ready for the lift that it's going to need to get it off the racetrack. If you are new to ASA, we will tell you, or if you're not new, we'll remind you that even if we run the next five or six laps under caution, we'll stop the lap count at lap 295. And no matter what, Mike Miller will have five green flag laps to try to chase down and pass arch rival Mike Eddy.
Oh boy, that will be fun. The excitement is just beginning to mount here. I hope you can feel it at home as we can here in Toledo. So join us in just a moment when we come back.
It has sleek, stunning lines, precise engineering, an innovative, award-winning design, and a sporty power red finish. But we're not here to amaze you with its finish. We're here to amaze you with its start. Just pull the trigger, push the button, and you're trimming. No hassles, always easy. The revolutionary new Home Light Push Button Start Trimmer. Sure, it's got a great finish, but you'll love it for a start.
Work boots. There's one place they don't work. Inside, they just don't have much cushioning. Dr. Scholl's Maximum Comfort work insoles give you 100% more cushioning. They make work easier on your feet.
Now at Pep Boys, get any four of our 35,000-mile all-season steel-belted tires at an incredible low $99.96. That's right, any size, any set of four, just $99.96 at Pep Boys now.
Welcome back, everybody. There is the disabled car of Rick Miller going into the pit on the hook, so to speak. That is what brought out the caution flag that will close the field up. And if this isn't enough excitement for you, tune in to TNN on Sunday, June 25th, 4 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Central. The AC Delco Challenge Series presents the Pontiac Excitement 300. We've got some Pontiac excitement going on right here among the first and second. And there are some more races on the schedule. That'll be from Brainerd International Raceway in Brainerd, Minnesota, a road course, or alternative drive style, as we call it. We are back to green flag racing. Now remember, it is Mike Miller in the Tomato 18, four spots back. There are three cars in between the orange 18 and the black 88. Well, at least there were.
Matt Hunter separating the two, a car painted identically to Glenn Allen Jr.'s. He is one lap down, and I think in car number 05. We're showing 11 cars on the lead lap. Mike Eddy, Mike Miller, Joe Knott still runs in third, looking for a career best finish. Bob Seneker, Rick Beebe, and Hunter now moves over. Johnny Benson is sixth, Gary St. Amant seventh, Steve Holthausen eighth, Scott Hansen ninth. 10th position is Dave Sensaba, and 11th, the last lead lap car, is number one, Jay Sauter.
We're six laps from the finish, one car separating the two leaders. And the leader is Mike Eddy in the black 88 Goodrich Pontiac. Here's Mike Miller still having a tough time trying to get around that 05 car. Matt Hunter. Hunter not so willing to get out of the way. Now, apparently, with this... Nope, he's still trying to race. And that only benefits Mike Eddy, who's just pedaling along out in front. And here's some stuff on the racetrack. That's some real, genuine, honest-to-goodness debris there, laying right on the finish line.
Well, I'll tell you, Brian, if I was Mike Miller's crew chief...
They brought the caution out.
Absolutely. With five laps to go, so we will still have five laps under green. I think that car number 05, Matt Hunter, finally did move over and allow Mike Miller to go by, which I think was wise, or there might have been a real good conversation after this race.
Let's go down to Ralph Shaheen down in the infield with another look at this.
I talked to Mike Miller's crew chief, and I asked him if they think they have anything for Mike Eddie. He said yes. All they had to do was get rid of the traffic in front of him. Now that they've done that, keep your eyes on turn number two. Mike is getting off that corner extremely well, and the 18's a rocket down the backstretch. That's where he's going to gun for him. The problem Mike Miller's going to have is coming off of turn number four if they race to the checker side by side. His car is extremely loose off of four, sideways lap after lap, and Mike Eddie is very stable coming off of four. And when you run into the checkered flag, stable is the way you want to go.
Some nail biting going on down there in the pits of Mike Eddie, of course, Howard Thomas, the veteran crew chief for the 88 Goodrich car, and Carl Hyland, a rookie crew chief, if you will. This is his first year, and there's an ASA official, that's Jeff Brown there, kicking that piece of whatever it is off the racetrack there. Oh, it must be a piece of exhaust system because it looked like it was hot. And here's a replay of a look at just what that was and where it was lying, right on the finish line as the cars worked their way back and forth, trying to keep those tires nice and warmed up. Here comes some stuff right at you, folks. Part of an exhaust system, I would have to guess. Oh, looked like Gary St. Amant just clipped it and sent it on its final path towards the wall.
It looked like brake ducting to me initially, which is the corrugated material, but the way it bounced and moved, I'm not sure that it was. It looked like something maybe a little heavier than that.
Something metal and something hot.
Wins winning move, what would be your vote? I don't know. I think maybe the pass that Mike Miller made of Joe Knott, that might be my vote.
To put him, I'd have to agree, because it put him in a position to be where he is right now. He was able to move into second place and challenge for the victory in this Glass City 300. I'd have to say the wins winning move would be Mike Miller. Of course, what an icing on the cake it would be if he could also get around and win this race.
Well, we don't cast the deciding vote, but I think we both agree on what our choice might be today.
Well, the only other obvious choice, but you'd have to call it a wins winning non-move, would be Mike Eddie's choice not to go into the pits, which put him in the lead.
Yeah, that's a possibility. Remember when Bob Seneca avoided what looked like sheer disaster on the front stretch?
That was a winning move in terms of life preservation, anyway. We're back to green. Five laps to go in this race. The lap counter had said 296. They've cranked it back to 295. That's the way it works in the American Speed Association. And Mike Miller in the orange 18 trying to get around the black 88 of Mike Eddie. A car length or two in between them, as you can see, as they hit the line now with four laps to go. This is turn two. Now, that's where they had said, where Ralph Shaheen said that Mike Miller's car was better. Here they come to the turn 3-4 area on this asymmetrical racetrack, where Ralph Shaheen said that Mike Eddie's car was better. But look at Mike Miller pulling up close to him. A little glimpse, as you can see. He was a little weavy back there, a little happy in the rear end, as you say.
Catching him is one thing, putting the pressure on is another, getting around him is an entirely different matter. And I think that Mike Miller is going to have to use his race car if he intends to get around Mike Eddie. And I don't mean just drive it, I mean use it as a battering ram.
Two laps to go. These two guys have a lot of respect for one another, and it looks as though Mike Eddie, driving along out in front, has maintained the gap between himself and Mike Miller. If anything, Mike Miller runs up close to him in the turns. Mike Eddie a little softer, perhaps, going on braking, and then he runs back out in front in the straightaway.
White flag, Brian, just half a lap to go, and I think time is out for the pole sitter fast qualifier. Mike Miller won only once in his ASA career back in the early 80s, but a brilliant run from deep in the field at the midpoint of this race.
And yet another victory for the seventh-time American Speed Association champion. So the celebration is in the pit of the Goodrich Pontiac number 88, and a celebration of a similar sort will certainly be going on in the pit for the orange 18 of Mike Miller, because after sitting on the pole for the very first time in his career, he has now posted a near-career best second-place finish. He did win a race in the American Speed Association, but that came some dozen or more years ago. We'll be back in just a little while to talk to all of the competitors that have mattered in this race. You'll meet them when we return here on America's Premier Short Track Series.
You know, a lot of people who work on their cars will only shop at AutoZone. They depend on us for the best quality parts and low prices every day. They come in, get what they need, and then get back to work. Because you see, they believe if you want the job done right, you do it yourself. Well, at AutoZone, we couldn't agree more. Because when you take the time and the effort to work on your car yourself, you ought to be choosy about where you shop. We just thank you for choosing AutoZone.
There was no mistake about it. I was definitely in cruiser heaven. Even my wife looked somehow different. And there I was, prowling the streets on the new Kawasaki Vulcan 800. V-twin rumbling, chrome gleaming in the sun. Is this for real, or am I just dreaming?
The Vulcan 800 from Kawasaki. It's as real as it gets.
They're state-of-the-art purebred racing machines. But please, don't call them cars. It's the Super Truck Series Jerden Nelson Truck 150, Saturday on TNN Motorsports.
For me, the off-season is the hardest part of the year. Testing, tuning, second-guessing, searching for that perfect combination. Then one day, the wait is over. There's a tension in the air. You can feel it. That's racing, and it's time to turn it loose.
TNN Motorsports. It doesn't get any closer.
I'm Rick Benjamin on the PM edition of Race Day. This week we'll have all the highlights from the left and right turn course in Sonoma. We'll tell you who the winners were in sprint cars, super trucks, and road racing too on the PM edition of Race Day this Sunday.
All you need to know about motorsports. Race Day. Tonight, 7:30 p.m., 6:30 Central, only on TNN Motorsports.
The 1995 AC Delco Challenge Series on TNN is brought to you in part by Wynn Oil Company, makers of quality automotive car care products. Remember, when it's Wynn, it works. By your GM Goodrich service dealer, we want your business. By Dr. Scholl's Insoles and Inserts, maximum comfort for work shoes and boots. And by Pep Boys Automotive Supercenters. The checkered flag has waved, and it has waved over one more time. Mike Eddy, the seven-time ASA champion, is now 2-for-2 for this 1995 season and well on his way to what perhaps will be an unprecedented 8th championship in a major stock car series. Let's go down to the infield where Ralph Shaheen will preside over the ceremony.
You know, I'm amazed with Mike Eddy. Every time I think I know everything there is to know about Mike Eddy, which for me usually isn't a whole lot, but he surprised me with something. This is the first time you've won at Toledo, is that true?
Well, it's the first time I've won an ASA race here. It seems like if anything can go wrong, it'll go wrong here. But today, things went pretty flawless for us.
Tell me about the last five or so laps. You had Mike Newton behind you. You knew he was strong. Did you know where he was going to try to get you?
Well, you know, we only pitted twice, and we changed the rights on lap 116, so we had 200 laps on the right, and they were pretty slippery, you know. But I think everybody was in the same shape as I was, and restarting there was just a matter of staying on the bottom and not getting in the gas too hard and getting the car loose off the corner.
All right, we've been searching for 8 championship. We've got 2 wins in a row here. Is this a freight train that's going to be real hard to derail before the season's over?
Well, you know, if it is, it sure wouldn't hurt my feelings. We're just going at it a race at a time and try and get this GM Goodrich Service Pontiac in the winner's circle each time or as close as we can, and then maybe that 8th one will come.
I know I wouldn't upset this guy either. Brent Snelson, of course, from AC Delco. Got to be pretty pleased with this guy today.
Oh, I tell you what, Mike's been here many, many times and a true champion, and you know, we're so proud to be the sponsor again of the series this year, and then to see our driver win it, it's actually extra special.
All right, one more question for you. We got IRP coming up next, and we haven't had the tour back there in a while. Do you think you have something for them there? Did you do the open test session?
No, I never did the test session. I've raced a lot at Raceway Park, and you know, them old racetracks, they never change. They can change the faces, but they're always the same. We'll just wait and see, but I'd like to make it 3 down there.
Can't change this guy either. The Polar Bear, one of the toughest competitors on the ASA Tour.
And you know, I just heard something, Brian, that may be a little cause for hope for the rest of the drivers. Maybe Mike Eddy is suffering from severe memory loss. He won an ASA race here back in 1981. But since then, he's only finished 4 out of 9. That's probably why he's erased this place from his memory bank.
Well, Mike Eddy, nevertheless, has his second victory in 1995 here at Toledo Motor Speedway, 14 years after he won another one that he can't remember. We're going to come back and talk to a lot more folks here because there are a lot more of them to talk to. and we'll do that right after this commercial break. These folks aren't going anywhere, don't you either.
If you settle for a remanufactured engine without a brand name, be sure you've got a pair of name brand shoes. AC Delco Engines, the national brand name with the nationwide warranty. Call for a location near you. Of course, if you come in on foot, we'll understand.
If you're looking for a reliable place to service your car or truck, I've got great news for you. It's a Pep Boys Automotive Super Center. No matter what you drive, their ASC certified technicians are here when you need them, day or night, even on Sunday. Or Raybestos Brakes, DRW Rack and Pinion Repair, Diagnostic Tune-Ups, even air conditioning. For dealer quality service at prices you can afford, come to Pep Boys and drive away happy.
There's a killer out there. Silent Knock.
Today you don't hear the knocks and pings that affect your car's performance. You just lose power.
So long, lost power. Hasta la vista, hesitation. Let's take this turn north.
Feel the power. 104 Plus Octane Boost.
With three kinds of chicken and all kinds of delicious side dishes, you can put together so many different meals at KFC. Hey, you may never have to have the same meal twice.
Everybody needs a meal. KFC.
He's your best friend, and he's also killing your back. If nothing seems to help, try Dones. It relieves back pain no matter where it hurts. Dones has an ingredient these pain relievers don't have. Dones, the back specialist.
Welcome back to Toledo, everybody, and now we're looking down on the Tomato 18, as I call it, of Mike Miller, Marietta, Georgia driver of the Atlanta Communications Pontiac, is the next guest of Mr. Ralph Shaheen.
Well, you know, he was telling us at the beginning of this race that Mike Miller and Dick Trickle had talked earlier in the week. I think you were talking to Steve Kinzer, because you spent a lot of time sideways coming off that corner. Was it that tough to drive it?
Well, the car was perfect coming off of two, but it was a little loose coming off four. This Wagner-powered Pontiac Grand Prix was close today, but just not quite close enough.
Does that mean that the program is right there? Did all that testing in the wintertime pay off now?
Yeah, I think that we're going to be in pretty good shape. If this is a precursor of things to come, we're going to be all right.
IRP is up next on the schedule. Do you have something for them there, too?
Well, we tested, and we got going pretty good there. It's going to be very enjoyable.
Tell me about those last five laps with Mike. Could you just not get him?
Well, I was just... on the restarts, I just couldn't get going. You know, I needed about 30 laps or so, and with the second last caution there, I just had to get going, but I couldn't.
Angela Montgomery is here with us as well. She's the director of motorsports for the folks at Pontiac. Now, Pontiac's struggling in some of the other stock car series, but here you guys are really owning it. This has got to be great for you.
Yes, Pontiac is very excited about our ASA performance. We've started the season off really strong, and it's just been a great season so far. We hope it'll continue.
Sure, you guys like that money they kick in, too, huh?
You bet.
Hey, hi, Mom and Dad. Say hi to Trickle, too. He did wonders for you, too. Mike Miller with a fine second-place finish here today.
That's going to be a very happy extended Mike Miller clan. Boy, there's lots up there spread all over the country, and they got to be loving life today. We'll be right back.
Developed Sensitrac shocks to smooth out the road for a comfortable ride. But Sensitrac doesn't stop there. It's the only shock that also gives you extra control when you need it most. Sensitrac shocks and struts, only by Monroe. For comfort and control. Get Sensitrac shocks. Call 1-800-STRUT now for a Monroe ride expert near you.
Over the years, Little Caesars has run promotions with many of its neighbors. Two pizzas and a back rub. Two pizzas and a colorful fish. And some chattering teeth. And this thing. And one of our most popular, the perm.
I'll never top that one.
Finally, two pizzas and a movie.
Wow.
It's the Blockbuster Video Pizza Pizza Deal. Buy a top-of-the-line Little Caesars Pizza Specialty Pizza, medium one-topping pizza, and get a free Blockbuster Video rental when you rent two.
Pizza Pizza.
I thought I was smart. I paid less for another protectant. It said it shined like Armorall, so I figured it protected like Armorall, too. But it didn't. You should see what the sun did to my dashboard. Some bargain.
Armorall doesn't just shine. Armorall provides superior protection against car vinyl discoloration.
No bargains for this, baby. I'm only using Armorall.
Armorall. When it comes to protection, there are no bargains.
Tonight on TNN Outdoors, on Fishing with Orlando Wilson, Orlando reveals the secrets to really big bass. On Fishing with Roland Martin, Roland reels in the best angling action from Miami to Michigan. On Bassmasters, Ray Scott hosts top tournament competition where it's a test for the best. And on The Great American Outdoors, if you're looking for adventure, Ron Shearer's got it. Catch all the action tonight on TNN Outdoors.
They're handing out the hardware in Toledo at Toledo Speedway for the Glass City 300. There's a look at your top three. In the center is Mike Eddy, the winner of the race. To the left, Mike Miller. And to the right, Joe Knott. What a terrific run he had in the number 48 car. They're handing out the spoils of victory here. And, of course, part of what we do every week is to vote for the win's winning move. And in spite of our best efforts to give it to Ralph Shaheen for his performance on the dance floor last night, calmer heads have prevailed, and we have awarded it for the very first time, not to a driver, but to a crew, or specifically a crew chief, Howard Thomas, for his decision not to pit when a lot of the other leaders did. That left Mike Eddy out on the racetrack and was never challenged for the victory in this race. So he is now with Ralph Shaheen, our win's winning move victor, Howard Thomas.
Man, and I thought I put out my best performance, too, last night. Oh, well, these are the tires that are on Mike Eddy's car on the left side, and you can see they're pretty much not a whole lot left there. But, Howard, you guys made a great call in keeping Mike Eddy out there. Congratulations, you and the rest of the Goodyear Service Pontiac team did make the winning move of the race. We congratulate you on that. Why did you do that? Is it just Mike, or do you just know the car better?
Well, Mike, you know, he's very smart about his race car. You know, he lives racing, and he understands what's going on, and he knows more than anybody, you know, how hard he's using the tires. And the first set of tires we took off, they looked really good. So we just assumed that we could go all the way.
This team is really on a roll right now. Is this a freight train that's going to be extremely hard to derail, or have you guys just gotten lucky the first two races?
Well, you know, there's a lot of luck involved in racing. So, you know, you can call it whatever you want, but we're on a roll, like you say, and we hope to carry on. We don't want to lose any momentum.
I call it preparation at home with Mike Eddy and good knowledge behind the head of the crew chief, Howard Thomas, here in pit lane. That's what's making the difference on this group.
Well, they say in a lot of cases, you make your own luck. The harder you work, the luckier you get. And we congratulate our wins winning move winners, the crew of the number 88 GM Goodrich Service Pontiac.
Now, my vote for Wynn's winning move went to our second-time director, Ed Collins, for not missing a thing today.
We have to congratulate Ed Collins for a great job in the truck, along with the rest of our crew. We'll get a chance to thank them even more throughout the course of this year. We want to thank you for sticking around, but we're not done yet, so come on back.
It has sleek, stunning lines, precise engineering, an innovative, award-winning design, and a sporty power red finish. But we're not here to amaze you with its finish. We're here to amaze you with its start. Just pull the trigger, push the button, and you're trimming. No hassle, always easy. The revolutionary new Home Light push-button start trimmer. Sure, it's got a great finish, but you'll love it for its start.
Speed. Excitement.
Sliding out of control, spinning.
Pocono Raceway. See speed and excitement.
Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and the stars of Winston Cup Racing invade Pocono Raceway twice in 95. June 11th, it's the UAW GM Teamwork 500. July 16th, it's the Miller Genuine Draft 500. Both events sold out in 94. Call 1-800-RACEWAY now while tickets last. Operators standing by.
You just spray it on.
You just spray it on.
Quicksilver Wheel Cleaner from Armor All. Just spray it on, and then just spray it off.
That's it? That's it.
Quicksilver Wheel Cleaner.
Head to Ace Hardware Maydays. They'll cover all your springtime needs and plant some new ideas in your head with a steady flow of quality products, all at rock-bottom prices. Ace Maydays. Hurry in while it's in full bloom.
I learned to change oil with my dad out in the driveway when I was little. We always went to Walmart for just about anything. I buy my oil by the case at Walmart. I buy Quaker State. I use 10W-30 in the winter and 10W-40 in the summer. I have a drain pan that the oil goes right into. I put the lid on and take it back to Walmart. It's real easy. They recycle it for me. My husband bought me some ramps for Christmas so that I would change his oil when I change my oil. Change his oil? He must be kidding.
America's premier short track series has come to a temporary conclusion, at least here. The second race of the season has ended with Mike Eddy taking the victory over Mike Miller in a hard-fought battle throughout the race. And sort of hidden a little bit, perhaps, behind the battle for first place was a great run by the guy that ended up in third spot. And that would be Joe Knott, the number 48 machine, with a brand new hood on there today in the Allen Knott Toyota Raby 4. And he is now with Ralph Shaheen. Ralph?
Well, he put that Valvoline hood right up in the thick of things, Joe Knott. Way to go today. Is this more a sign of your maturing as a driver or what Chris Bradley is doing with you as your new crew chief?
I think it's really coming down to Chris Bradley. He's really given me the confidence. And, boy, we couldn't have done a better job other than hire him. You know, he's really got this whole crew working good. Like I said, Allen Knott Motorsports Raby 4 Thunderbird ran great today. Couldn't be better Valvoline on the hood for the first race. You know, we're really happy for that. And, car was loose, you know, the whole race, and just had to drive around it. We had a spark plug wire burn up halfway through the race, and we did a two-tire stop and plus changed the spark plug wire and didn't even lose a lap. You know, that says a whole lot for the crew. Really great. And towards the end, we really didn't have anything for second place. We're pretty far behind them, but just wanted to hold off Seneca. You know, he was getting underneath me, and the only thing I could do was just keep him from going there.
Well, you're on the podium. What do you got to do now to move farther up the podium?
Well, just, you know, keep racing hard and stay out of trouble. I've got, you know, a couple stickers on my dash that say consistency. And, boy, I tell you what, every time I look at that, it means a lot.
Joe Knott, third place here at Toledo.
And Brian, just 22 years of age.
A terrific run for him. Business as usual for the winner of this race, Mike Eddy. He's been there before. A career first pole position for Mike Miller and the best finish for him in a long, long time. And for Joe Knott, a career best finish for him in third spot, so we had a lot of firsts here today. And there you see the rest of the field. Bob Seneca didn't quite get around Joe Knott. Rick Beebe, what a great run for him from 28th to 5th. And there we have a full field rundown. We hope you are looking at your favorite driver and just where that driver finished. Glenn Allen Jr., look at him, all the way down in 20th spot. So certainly coming out of this, Mike Miller will move to second in points, perhaps, considering the misfortune of the others that were ahead of him. Mike Eddy stays out in front of the points battle for the season and for the moment. Here's the rest of the field. 38 cars started the race, and we will run them all down for you.
And as you continue to look at the unofficial results, we will update you unofficially. Mike Eddy will lengthen his points lead to 20 over Mike Miller. Joe Knott vaults to third in the standings. Gary St. Amant will be fourth. Bob Seneca fifth. Sixth, Scott Hansen. Seventh will be Steve Holtzhausen. And Glenn Allen Jr. drops all the way to eighth. Ninth will be, I think, Brian Reffner. And in tenth position, car number 33, Brad Loney. So after a great start at Columbus, Loney and Glenn Allen now have to battle back.
Well, the winners of our race here are still basking in the afterglow and receiving the accolades of the crowd, well-wishers, autograph seekers. We want to let you know about our next race, and that's Brainerd. The Brainerd 300 in Brainerd, Minnesota, on the road course up there, alternative drive style, as they say, making rights and lefts. Mostly lefts, however, on that racetrack. There are a couple of left turns and a lot of rights. But here is the tail end of the car that ended up winning. So if you can win, even when your car looks like that, you're doing a good job. And, of course, Mike Eddy has done a good job for a long time, as have these folks, our executive producer, John Petrie, and our producer, Joel McKee, and the rest. These are the folks that make it possible for us, K. to bring you such a great broadcast and for us to enjoy the time that we have in the booth together. So for my partner and teammate and good friend Rob Albright up here in the booth, and for Ralph Shaheen down in the pits, for our colleague Josh Duvall, this is Brian Drebber saying so long from Toledo.